rather lengthy agenda this evening. So first up, we have recognitions, and then we will have our first opportunity for public comment. We have reports to the school committee, which actually I wanted to ask the committee if you had any objection to our moving the superintendent's report to further down in new business to just before the town meeting warrant in letter J, because Dr. McLeod and I feel like some of that discussion will take a long time and hold up some of our administrators this evening. So if we could move that down, it would be appropriately placed before the warrant. So, okay.
Sure.
So we will first hear from the student council, then we'll have liaison reports and school committee chair report. We will move Dr. McLeod's report down into new business. Under new business, we have a director of finance and operations appointment. We have an athletic field committee recommendation, an intent to travel field trip request. We actually have a number of field trip requests, four. And then we have the YMCA before and after school program renewal discussion, school bus contract renewal discussion, school committee policy, IHBB extended school year discussion, and then we will have Dr. McLeod's report, and the town meeting warrant will end our new business. And then on to old business, we have a overnight trip for the girls lacrosse team, a tech vote on being a member, and as well as our FY18 capital article request discussion. We'll then have our second opportunity for public comment thereabouts 9:40, and then our items by consensus. At this time, Dr. McLeod, we have recognitions before us this evening.
Yes, thank you. I'd like to invite Evan Bishop. Could you come up and along with Dan and Colette? So we have Dan Palico and Colette Fritch. Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Congratulations. Thank you so much for being here. I asked Evan to give more of an overview of your accomplishments and the award itself, and so you can take it.
Sure. It's my privilege to introduce Dan and Colette, two of our seniors at the high school, two of our best and brightest, wonderful kids, and they have received the honor of having a status of a National Merit Finalist, which is very impressive. To get to that point, they had to be first named semifinalists, which is they scored in the top 1% index score in the PSAT when they took it back sophomore year, which is very impressive. There are only two of 16,000 students in the country that were semifinalists, and then to get to be a finalist, they have to go through quite the process of an application. Their guidance counselor has to submit a letter of recommendation. There's an essay process. So they were able to complete that and be named finalists, which is extremely impressive. Not surprised by the two of them. They are, like I said, wonderful kids and very smart and do so much for the community and for our school. So very proud of them. It's a wonderful honor. And maybe we can give a little round of applause to them for that. I don't know if you guys want to talk a little bit about the process or maybe what you're planning on doing.
That'd be great.
Yeah, next year.
It actually wasn't that bad, the application. It was a process. You didn't have to complete an application, but it wasn't that bad after all college applications. It could have been worse.
Yeah, it was much better than college applications.
Yeah.
So you said that they were two of 16,000 for the semifinals round. What is the finalist round pool look like?
I think it's like 14,000.
Yeah, 14,000.
Oh, wow.
Yeah,
something
that's,
like that.
Yeah.
As long as you do it, basically. There aren't any, red flags.
Very impressive.
GPA a certain amount, but just being able to be named a semifinalist based on having that score on the PSAT is really outstanding.
Wow.
You guys can downplay it, but it's an impressive.
Well, you know, we saw you in the newsletter, and we just wanted to see you live because it's just, that much more. So thanks so much for coming out.
No problem. Thank you.
Is it fair to ask what you're doing next year? Do you know yet?
Yes, I'm going to Northeastern.
Yes.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
I'm going to major in bio, and I want to be a vet. So
awesome.
Wow.
Excellent.
Have you decided yet?
I have not decided where I'm going.
Sure, you have a lot of
I'm deciding between Notre Dame, Georgetown, Duke, and Dartmouth.
Wow.
Probably international relations, but that's open to change. So.
Some excellent choices.
To keep it open. And knowing each of you a little bit, I know that studying is not the only thing you do by any stretch of the imagination. So you balance a lot, and I know you both contribute a lot to the community here at the high school. So really, really well done. Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Really good job.
Thank you.
Next, I'd like to invite Bruce Elliott, if you could come up and help us to recognize Christine Basil.
Christine, come on up.
I'll let you
pick. We have to sit? Okay.
Well, you don't have to sit.
We have chairs for you guys.
No, there won't be any depositions taken
no.
or anything.
No.
We just deal in facts.
We just need your email records.
Exactly. Start passing over the financial records. But, I just wanted to obviously recognize Christine for her award that is very well deserved. It was the 2017 Mayford Elementary Teacher of the Year Award that we're speaking here tonight about. And it's awards recognized for exemplary service leadership contribution to the profession of physical education. So I wanted to give a little bit of a background on what the award, how the award is scored out. Mayford, which is the organization that gives out these awards on a yearly basis, basically classifies the utilization of various teaching methods and plans for innovative learning and methods to meet all students' needs. And Chris is paramount is to her ability to meet all students' needs. If you ever have a chance to take a trip over to Elmwood, she's always helping out students across the spectrum and does a great job with those students and getting them motivated, I would say. She will have anybody that walks into her classroom pretty much full speed running through a wall at some point if she can.
Safety.
I know. She's trying to pump you up.
You don't say that now.
Trying to pump you up. So positively, also positively demonstrate role model, epitomizing personal health, fitness, enjoyment of activity, sportsmanship, and as I said, sensitivity to students' needs. Participate in professional development opportunities and serve on state, district, and national committees as well. Her accomplishments, Chris has been in the district for 15 years now. She's spoken at Mayford, as we have mentioned, with fellow wellness members, Deb Pinto, John Parker, and also Bob Burlow. Additionally, she spoke about the Marathon Fitness Program over at Elmwood with Laura McKenzie, right? Mm-hmm. And Jan Gill and Beth Ryder as well. Yep. And she's an active member for the American Heart Association for the Jump Rope for Heart program. Personally, Chris has been inducted into the Attleboro Basketball Hall of Fame for achievements as a player at Bishop Feehan High School, and also into the New England New Agenda Hall of Fame for her involvement with promoting girls and women in sport. She's just recently written a foreword, right, for Erin Mahoney's book on girl power.
Nice.
So quite the accomplishment here. So much well-deserved, probably long overdue.
That just means I'm old.
No. She does a great job every day. Comes in highly energized. Kids get energized. And it's just a pleasure. Every time I walk in there, she does a great job.
Thank you.
So,
Chris, I know you're never short on words. So, what would you like to say to us in terms of this award and what it means to you?
I'm in good company with Deb Pinto and John Parker. As a school committee, you should be really excited that we have three members of our staff that have been recognized by the state. And I want to thank all of you and the support that you give us financially and the support that we have from our administration to be a very high-level, cutting-edge, quality physical education department, at least at the level that I see, which every day is in the elementary program. And I want to thank Bruce Elliott. In the 15 years I've been here, he has really opened the lines of communication to the elementary teachers more than any other wellness subject matter leader that I've worked with. And I'm not just saying that because you're sitting here. You've done a great job.
He keeps us involved.
He has seen us teach more than any other subject matter leader that we've had. He gives us feedback on it, both as a health educator, you come in, as a physical educator. He really knows what we do, and that really means a lot to us. Sometimes people think, oh, you're at the elementary school. You know, you're at the bottom of the totem pole, and we don't feel that way. You know, we, as Bruce says, we come in all out, and the women that I work with, Jan Gill and Beth Ryder, are fantastic, and they'll be sitting here, because the chemistry that we have, the synergy, the work now with Neely Bartley coming over as our tech person that works in our building, what we're doing now is sensational. It's really, really exciting. And there's nothing that gets me more excited than when you work with an individual and a little child that can't do something. And you can film them. We have iPads that we have now through parents that have given them to us as gifts. And we film the children when they can't do the skill. And then they can follow it along and say, all right, see what's happening here. Then we can do it in slow motion. They can see it right there, right on the spot. And then you have the finished product when they finally can do it. And I cannot tell you how many children are jumping up and down in the gym and hugging us and happy because it's a forward roll, or they can finally jump rope, or they can finally achieve something that they couldn't do before. And that's what keeps us going. That's our inspiration from the children. And, you know, with Neely coming in with her technology, with the knowledge of, it's like everyone, Beth and Jan and I all have very different skills. But I think we complement each other very well. And when we sit in a meeting, a little idea becomes something that's really dynamic for the children. And it's something that we really think it's important that we motivate them so that they try. And we're trying to get them to the point when they say, I can't do it, that we just say, yet. And we want that to be part of their mindset as we talk about the growth mindset. If they can say, I can't do it yet, but, and we keep telling them that's why we're there. We're there to help you to learn those things. And we try to support them in that way, both in their physical skill and their emotional development. And that's what's exciting.
That's right.
And I think that's what Bruce sees us do. And that's what I'm so pleased to be here and to do the work that we do. And some of you, I know I've had some of your children, and it's fun.
I would say thank you personally, because I have a daughter at Elmwood this year, and she loves you, and she loves phys ed. And I think the most important aspect for me is that there weren't, at least when I was growing up, a lot of strong role models in physical education that were women. And so for her to see that and see that how sportsmanship can be applied from having a woman leader in that role, I think is very important. So I thank you and congratulate you as well. And you'll have another Nickerson child on their way next year. So
That's fine. It's just a new challenge, but we're excited. Thank you. Thank you for your comments.
I'd say, too, again, you know, personally speaking, it's an odd year for me because I don't have a child at Elmwood, which is the first time that's happened in a while. But, again, that'll be solved next year. But I have a middle schooler who it's funny you gave the example of the jump rope, because I have a middle schooler who still talks about the jump rope experience and not being able to even do one when she started her Jump Rope for the Heart campaign, and the motivation and growth and how proud she was of herself at her final number, and the fact that stuck with her and allowed her to grow, I think really is you know, a testament to, as I said, she still talks about it. So
that's
a testament to the work that you're doing there and how well-deserved this award is.
Oh, thank you very much.
I appreciate that.
I just wanted to share that I was reviewing the agenda, and I was sharing with my children, who I have a daughter who's in high school, that you had won the award. And said, oh my gosh, she's the best. So
the impact lasts many years.
So congratulations.
Well, thank you very much. Well, hopefully that good feeling, they'll stand here and receive other awards in front of you in their future, because they feel good about themselves and they feel good about moving.
Well, I was reflecting that we're rapidly approaching our favorite day, one of our favorite days of the year, which is Kenyon Runner Day at Elmwood School, which is when I always get to see you at least once a year, which I enjoy. But I always love to see, you know, the high school track kids that come back. So they're high school or older kids in the building, and all of them remember you, and there's hugging. And I mean, you clearly make a long-lasting impact on the kids. And I think the passion that you just demonstrated sitting here and talking about what you do makes it very evident why this is probably a long overdue, but certainly well-deserved.
Thank you very much. So there's this little boy, he's about this big, a little blonde-haired kid. He calls the day, if he comes in the morning when I have my hall duty, gives me a hug, And then he goes, that's one. And every time he goes by me in the hallway, he'll go, that's two. And if he sees me in the cafeteria, that's three. And when he goes on the bus for bus 30, he goes, this was a full hugger day.
Aww.
And he gives me a hug. And I say, oh, my gosh. If I can't love what I'm doing, right, then I shouldn't be here. But, you know, this is a five-hugger day. So thank you. Thank you for all your comments. I appreciate that.
Well, thank you.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thanks, Chris.
Dismissed.
Great.
You're
welcome to
No bus duty.
Thank you. Have a good evening. I hope I didn't make it too long.
No. Stay dry.
I'm going to send you back out.
Thank you, Bruce.
Thank you.
Oh, crazy. And next we have Doug Scott. And although I don't need any help in recognizing you, I would like Evan to join us if you could.
Those are the best days.
Yeah.
She's the reason.
We should put these at the end.
Oh, my gosh,
sweet. She's the reason I just
so got on that. It was interesting because as we were putting the agenda together, I didn't even have all these that Doug's here to talk about tonight when I had put his name under recognitions. And it was really because, Doug, you have just brought so many opportunities to our engineering department at the high school. I mean, I just hear constantly what great things are happening, and I know myself what great things are happening, but you've really made a significant impact on our program here at the high school, and you've extended it beyond that, you know, to more than you can even handle at this point.
True.
But Doug, you're also really, really good at recognizing other people. And I, you know, at first, you know, I had received this email from you, basically to me, recognizing all of the people that have helped you with your various clubs. And it just really stood out to me that it was really important that we recognize all of the things that you've done, but also that leadership that you show. I think in recognizing our kids, our volunteers, our staff, you make people want to work harder for you, and you have just demonstrated such great leadership that I wanted to personally recognize you and thank you for everything you've done in a very short, not even 2 years, in our district.
Thank you.
So thank you. Evan, I know you probably want to add to that.
Sure.
Okay.
Well said. Yeah, I often say that the most important thing that principals will do, will hire, and he has been one of the best hires that we have made. He has done a wonderful job. I've enjoyed working with Doug very much in the last year and a half. He has taken that department and changed it in such a positive way. We have so many kids down that wing of the school now taking part in engineering classes and robotics. We have robotics competitions here at the high school. He's added so much in such a short period of time, like you said. It's very, very impressive. And you know, we talk almost every day trying to continue to make improvements. And obviously, we're still at the beginning phases, but we have a lot planned for his department and with different offerings and different courses. But we have the right person in place to really do big things when it comes to our technology and engineering and business and kind of visual arts and media arts department. So I'm very proud of Doug and the work that he does. And, you know, I'm happy to have him on staff. He does an excellent job.
Thank you.
I know.
I don't handle this well.
Oh. So just letting you know.
I have a friend of mine from a former district, and she would always say, God, just say thank you, you know. I was like, okay, thank you.
Well, you'll be back for more business where I know you're in a much more comfortable seat, and we're going to be hearing some things from you at that time as well. But I didn't know if the school committee had anything they wanted to add.
So I just want to, I don't have a child who's in the high school yet, and we've never actually met before, but I get most of my information, like most people, through Twitter. Oh. And so I follow the high school Twitter account, and I am constantly stunned by the number of times there are activities that come up either retweeted through your account or noted that you are the faculty sponsor of it, to the point where I often find myself going back through and like, is that the same person?
Yeah.
As somebody who's not even has a child in the high school yet, just through that medium, it's so obvious what your commitment is to this school, this district, and the program. That even in 140 character spurts, it comes across. And so just thank you for everything that you're doing.
Yeah, I mean, from my end, I I'm very thankful. I appreciate working here. You don't know it, but when I was going through the hiring process, I visited a school committee meeting, oh. And I sat in the back with a hat on. I just sat there like this, and I said, "What's this town all about? And you know, what are they doing?" And I walked away, and I was super impressed. It was a meeting about, I can't even remember what it was, but it was very thoughtful the way that everybody went through everything. And the biggest thing that I came out of it was that everything was student-centric. And to me, that's really what I try to focus on, are the students. The first question I always ask when making a decision, whether it be something that I do personally or within the department, is it good for kids? And if it's no, it ends right there. Is it good for kids? And, you know, I'm very fortunate to work in a great supportive district and to work in a building where you have tremendous leadership. In all the years I've been doing this, this is very strong leadership that you have. And the staff is super supportive, and the kids are fantastic. I thought when I got hired here that, like, he had planted somebody at the front door, because when I walked in and walked out, a student held the door and said, "Hi, how are you?" And I walked out. I said, "Wow." I said, "These kids are really nice." And it's been that way ever since. So I'm very thankful to work with the kids here and to work with the staff here. So thank you.
Thank you,
thank
Doug.
You. Thank you very
so
much.
So we're going to have the student council. So we'll ask you to give up their seats for now, and then we'll bring you back.
Yep.
Except that we have public comment first.
Okay.
Can I just do one quick recognition? I just wanted to recognize Sue McClure, who watches all of our meetings and takes, she actually is the one who takes the minutes for us. It's a lengthy and a large commitment, and she's brought us up to date with the minutes. By our next meeting, we'll have everything that has not happened yet ready for approval. So,
yeah,
wow.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The invisible Sue McClure.
Yes.
Thank you.
She works hard, but.
Yep.
Can you imagine how excruciating it is to listen to?
I cannot.
Okay.
Thank you, Sue.
So we have our first opportunity for public comment. If there's anyone from the public that would like to speak at this time, there will be a second opportunity later in the meeting, but I wanted to give everyone the opportunity now. Okay. Our next item on the agenda, as Dr. McLeod stated, was our reports to school committee and student council. You guys are up first. And I know, Sarah, I know you from past meetings, but I'm sorry, I don't remember. Ryan.
Okay. Ryan Brand.
Thanks for coming out in the rain, guys, because it's torrential out there.
We had a very busy March and beginning of April at the high school, but lots of good things. I think the first thing that I want to start off with is the MICA Music Festival that we hosted this past weekend. I think we're one of 10 or so hosting sites around the state, so it's quite a feat to actually host it. And I know I'm in the band, and Mr. Hay and all the music teachers, Mr. Purdy, Mr. Dodge, Mr. McDonald, do an outstanding job of setting it up and finding volunteers to help out. And what's even better is that the concert band ended up getting a gold medal, and the orchestra ended up getting a gold medal. And the repertory band, which is made up of mostly freshmen and sophomores, got a silver medal. So that's outstanding. And the gold medal winners get the chance to play at Mechanics Hall, which is in Worcester, or Symphony Hall, which is obviously in Boston. A couple weeks ago, probably about a month ago, our jazz ensemble participated in the Massachusetts Jazz Ensemble Festival, which is kind of like the MICA equivalent just for jazz bands, and we ended up getting a silver medal there. But next Wednesday night is Hopkinton High School Jazz Night, so we have all of the jazz bands from 8th grade to the two high school ones performing there, and it's a very fun night. Switching gears kind of to spring sports, we started those, and I know a lot of teams' games got rained out, but even so, both lacrosse teams managed to get their first wins, and I know yesterday both the boys' and the girls' track teams got their first wins of the season as well. Another thing that happened today is...
Can I just say how remarkable that is, given that they haven't been able to practice?
Oh, yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. I mean, so other than in the gym.
Yeah.
Just saying. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Today, a club in our school called STOP, which stands for Students Taking On Poverty, hosted a juice fast in which you had to, I think the bare minimum was get $10 donated. Obviously, that's the minimum, and a lot of people exceeded that, in which it started at 6 last night and went to 6 tonight, so it's over. But fasted, and they raised money for a program that donates food to 50 countries around the world, mostly to countries in Africa. And I know Mr. Bishop fasted, participated today. May have been caught cheating, but that's okay.
those little candy things.
And also today we had a college fair for, I believe, the sophomores and juniors. Seniors didn't go because we're pretty much done with the process now. One other thing is next Thursday we have a wellness road trip for, I think, the sophomores, and they go rock climbing at a place in Worcester. And I know I couldn't go when I was a sophomore, but it's highly regarded. And I know some of my friends still say it was one of their favorite days of high school, so pretty impressive.
Then also next Thursday, I believe, we have our Day of Silence, which many students participate in all over the school, and it's to raise awareness for the LGBTQ community. And they won't be talking, sign language, anything. If necessary, they'll write something down, but their goal is to go all day. So we're very excited about that and very supportive of them. We also have a couple field trips coming up. We have 20 students that are participating in a business field trip to, I believe it's the Deloitte Institution. And then we also have a field trip that our special education department is taking next Tuesday to the movie theater. And I know I'm going as a peer mentor, and I'm very excited about it.
What are you going to see?
I'm actually not sure yet. I think we're going to pick when we're there, but they're all very excited about it. Yeah, we're teaching them the life skill of how to sneak snacks into the movie.
That's the life skills
part about it. And then also we had a principal's cabinet meeting today, and one of the main topics that we talked about was more parking spaces, because I know we've both dealt with this, that there is a limited number of parking spots, and people who have their license and a car don't necessarily get a spot to park in, or a lot of juniors face the issue of their parking like half a mile away from the school, and it makes it hard to get to and from, especially in weather like this. It's not ideal. So today we talked a lot about the pros and cons of making the field that's right behind the high school a parking lot, because we talked about that we really have only seen maybe the freshman field hockey team practicing on there like a couple times in the season. The field isn't in much use, so we wanted to put a proposal out to you guys to in the future have that paved so that we can use as a parking lot for closer parking. It'd actually be closer than senior lot. So it's our big proposal today.
Is that your senior class gift? Is that a preview?
Be a nice gift. So, yeah, that's what we have today.
There's a lot. Great. Thank you very much. You guys are making me tired of how busy you all are.
Thank you.
So next on our agenda, we have our liaison reports, and I don't know if any of my colleagues have any reports from your various areas.
Let's just try to figure that out. Have we had a meeting since? No, I don't think we have.
I mean, you've had a turf field meeting, so.
No, I'm doing the ESBC, but yeah.
Turf field, I think we're going to talk about it later.
Okay.
Just to add to that, we did start in a smaller group this morning about talking about
you know, management of the field and scheduling and how we can work together with Parks and Rec and the youth soccer to support each other with Fruit Street and whatnot. And so what I was thinking about after that I would like to bring up for our consideration maybe at the next meeting is when we originally set up the subcommittee we didn't have a Parks and Rec liaison as a member of the committee. I think that, you know, and I think as things have developed, I do think that that's an important voice. Dan Terry's been great about coming and participating in the meetings. We're working together closely with him on the field management thing. So I just would like to request that at our next meeting, we take that up as an agenda item and consider adding him officially as a liaison to the subcommittee, just to really sort of reinforce their voice at the table. Yeah, or Parks and Rec. I mean, I think Parks he's Rec. The one filling it, but...
I mean, we can talk about this next week. I think yeah. The reason why we were trying to keep it an odd number, weren't we?
Well, you're saying well,
he wouldn't,
not voting
he wouldn't be voting. So.
Oh, okay. Never mind. So we'll add that to the agenda.
Okay. Thank you.
So we have not had any SBC meetings since our last meeting, but our next one is on the 24th.
It's not until after our next meeting.
So. Right, 24th.
Right. So that's
so
all.
We'll talk about it in May.
Yeah.
I didn't know, Nancy, did we skip over you, or did you not have
I have nothing for this
okay.
week. I'll have more next week.
All right, so there was a meeting of the CPAC in the meantime between our last meeting and this meeting, and there was a lot of discussion around ESY, which is the extended school year, both the program offerings as well as transportation questions. And I'm not entirely sure if all the committee was aware, but there was a change to the transportation that was made, and then the change was reversed for this year in order to take a closer look at what the requirements are in terms of transportation for the ESY students over the summer, as well as the fact that there were many working parents who were distinctly impacted by the change. So that has been obviously an item of discussion both on social media as well as it was a topic of discussion that evening. I would say that actually was the primary discussion point. There was some discussion about except in the changes that they have put in place since January and the improvements that people have seen in transportation. And then obviously, tonight we'll be talking about an ESY policy, and I believe that policy came out of the discussion from that evening and the parent requesting to see the policy. So we'll get further into that later in the meeting. The next CPAC meeting is actually for May 16th, which is the day after my term ends. And prior to all that are left on the committee having your reorganization meeting. You know, I was thinking about this today and whether or not I would go to that meeting, and I don't have a problem going to the meeting, but I would also suggest that maybe one of the three of you that remain on the committee might plan to go to the meeting that night, just because I know Dr. McLeod will be in attendance, and also just to demonstrate some consistency in having a school committee member involvement until you have your reorganization meeting. So it's the 16th, which is a Tuesday night, 7 o'clock in the middle school. It's that lecture hall, not the library. But I just wanted to put it out there because I didn't realize until just today that's after the election. So that's my last liaison report. And then I do need to put forth our executive session minutes. During our executive session of March 16, 2017, the school committee voted to release the following executive session minutes that were previously voted unreleased. All of the minutes that we discussed that night were released, so I'm just going to read through the dates because they all had the same approval. So the dates are July 12, 2010, September 2nd, 2010, September 16th, 2010, October 7th, 2010, October 21st, 2010, November 4th, 2010, January 13th, 2011, January 20th, 2011, January 29th, 2011,
February 17th, 2011, March 3rd, 2011, March 11th, 2011, March 17th, 2011, April 7th, 2011, April 28th, 2011, May 12th, 2011, May 26th, 2011, Session 1, May 26th, 2011, Session 2, and June 9th, 2011. All were released. In addition, that's all. I do have some comments that were sent to me from members of the public, some in which you all the school committee received, and some that were just addressed to me in regards to the ESY policy, but I think it's better for us to discuss
it. I didn't get any. So.
Oh, really?
Mm-mm.
I thought that from Mr. Johnson that
I got
went to
one.
The...
Oh, that one.
That one went to
that was
the... Okay. Well, regardless, I have them on my phone, and I was going to relay the messages that we've received in terms of public comment in relation to that policy at the time we discussed the policy. So that's the end of my report, and we are moving Dr. Mataz's report, so we now can move on to new business. And our first item for new business, which we're actually running ahead of schedule.
Well, I asked her to be here at 8.
Okay. So
apologize.
We'll have her come in
is
at
that
time.
Right?
Yeah,
sorry.
That's fine. So we'll move on to the Athletic Field Committee Recommendation Letter B, and that's Dr. McLeod, Mrs. Birchman, and Mr. Graziano.
Who's talking?
We didn't rehearse this.
No, but I think I would, you know, defer to the two of you to summarize the most recent meeting, if you would. We have a consideration and a motion in the agenda, but I know that there's been also some discussion about potentially leaving it and having a no action item. So I'd rather turn it over to you.
Okay. Just a quick recap, you know, of where we are in the process. Dee came and gave us a good update. So we have reviewed the RFPs, and we're going to talk about that later and at the next meeting. But in the process of looking at where we are and where we need to get before we're ready to make a presentation to town meeting, the athletic field subcommittee didn't feel like they would be ready to make a comprehensive enough report at this year's town meeting, which is what we all kind of thought may happen. And we're sort of letting that process play itself out or as things unfolded. So that is the recommendation that the subcommittee voted to make to the school committee, that we not go forward with the article at the May 17 town meeting. So the options that we have are either just to remove it from the warrant, or a recommendation was made at the meeting to consider actually leaving it on the warrant but standing up at town meeting and voting to take no action, so that at least we have the opportunity to put it on the radar screen for the people at town meeting and just let them know that, I mean, obviously it's been on our capital spreadsheet since longer than I've been sitting at this table, and we know that's like centuries, but you know, just so that we have the opportunity to give a very brief heads up as to where we are in the process, and then it will be coming forward the following year. So I thought that was a pretty interesting and good recommendation. If we do that, I think then we have to do the warrant article, which we don't have, or I don't even know if we write those or the town does. But so that's sort of what the decision point is.
So one thing that I think also helped drive that decision that I think is important for the committee to know, and this is why it's great to put these volunteer subcommittees together, because you get expertise from all over the place. We had been operating under the assumption of the timeline that basically the only way to sequence this was to get the funding for construction at a town meeting a full year before okay. You were going to build. One of the subcommittee members actually has a lot of experience in this regard and outlined some options that the engineering firms have confirmed are very possible, which will allow us actually to defer the warrant article by a year, but not defer the construction. So we'd actually be able to, and we'll talk a little bit more about the details of this in the engineering firm presentation next week, but we would be able to essentially go all the way through the bid process for construction prior to a May 18 town meeting subject to appropriation, and then be able to go to that town meeting, get appropriation, and still target having a field built for the fall of 18. So it gives us a lot more time to work on the marketing campaign, if you will, the awareness campaign is probably a better word for it, but does not actually delay the project. or at least the aspirational project. So yeah, I think that's a I think that's an that's important critical, detail. Yeah.
So would it do the project a disservice to stand up at this year's town meeting if the awareness isn't fully baked from your... I'm just wondering, would the message change significantly such that if you attended only one of the meetings or that... that's just my thought. Like, if you start talking about it now and somebody goes to that meeting and then they tune out until next year and then they go again, would it have...
I don't think
it's to be confusing at all.
I think we already know, you know, I think there are some very huge parameters that aren't going to change. It's a phased project. We know which fields we think are important to do first. Okay. Certainly, we still are looking for a lot of public input during the course of the project. It sort of felt like an opportunity to let people know, you know, we really are looking for your participation and your feedback this year because we'll be back here next year. And it's not really, you know, appropriate for us to make a report at town meeting about this. But this did seem like an opportunity to at least give a brief heads up to people. It isn't something that I typically, I mean, certainly there are plenty of times where you've seen a committee stand up and take no action, but I don't remember us doing it sort of for this reason before, but I think that...
Do you feel comfortable with this?
I think just in terms of, you know, public information, I think it's actually kind of an advantage so that people aren't caught by surprise if they haven't been. I think also there's a lot of misunderstanding that, you know, there was an article in our own high school paper that it's, what was the headline? Rejected. It was like a big red circle of the line. Sign, yeah. And so that isn't the case. It isn't going forward this year, but that was the other reason that we thought it might be important to just be able to give the message that we're not asking you for money this year, but we haven't. This is not off the table. It's still a project that moves, that's moving forward. The school committee is, you know, commissioned feasibility studies, and we're going to talk next week about the money for the design. So,
yeah, I mean, even I was confused when I saw the article that said selectmen were removed from, and I was like, oh, geez,
yeah.
That sounds drastic.
Exactly. So we just thought it would be a good opportunity to make sure that people have an accurate update of where it stands now and where it's headed.
I mean, certainly public awareness over the next year is going to be critical. We've mm-hmm. talked about it. We've talked with the engineering firms about public forums and public meetings and the type of information campaigns that we've seen on some of these larger projects. But, again, recognizing that, shockingly, not a lot of people are watching our meetings, it gives us an opportunity in front of a larger audience to talk about the project. And so it sort of we can somewhat take advantage of a procedural methodology to be able to talk to the people who attend town meeting. Mm-hmm.
So I have a couple of questions on this because my gut reaction is this is a bad idea because I just feel like this has been such a contentious item already and we're in somewhat of a contentious place with the entire budget process right now. So I feel like it's a little bit of poking the bear. And that's just my gut reaction to it. But I guess my more, like, procedural question on it is, and this is where probably the misunderstanding as to what exactly the Board of Selectmen did. I mean, I thought there was a vote to remove the warrant article.
They can't remove the warrant article. They removed the ballot question.
Okay.
So we could go forward with a warrant article.
Okay, that's right.
We just can't do the debt exclusion if that's how it was going to be funded because they removed the... question.
Okay, so the other piece that I feel like may also come off negatively at town meeting is, depending on how this warrant article is written, I don't recall, and I could be wrong about this, but you don't typically have the committee's vote written in with the warrant article. So if the vote is to take no action, yet the warrant is actually asking for something, you're going to get people all fired up before town meeting, those of them that actually read the warrants ahead of time, which there are a few. And if there's nothing there stating that we're not taking any action, aren't you just creating a fervor that's not unnecessary?
Doesn't it say in the warrant, recommend no action?
It wouldn't say it from, I don't think it would say it from this sponsoring.
I think it usually says it in the motions document, maybe. Yeah. I'm honestly getting confused.
I remember there's something that already says that there's no motion.
Yeah, I do action. Think we had talked about this here, putting out the fast facts or whatever we're calling it, FAQs about all of our capital articles before town meeting, making them available on the website and whatnot. So that's a good point that I hadn't really thought about before, but if we are going to be posting those beforehand, those would be equally accessible, and we could, you know, could have on the fast fact sheet the information, but say the school committee recommends no action on this article this year.
Right, but the thing is, those aren't going to be linked to the town's warrant that's posted, and most people aren't going to, like, because we haven't done these fast facts or FAQs or however we decide to call them before, no one's going to be looking for those.
Yeah.
So what's going to, I just have concern that this is going to, I agree with you that the people that are at town meeting and having the opportunity to present what's to come is a great opportunity, but what I was just trying to figure out is there another way of doing it during our, you know, our future plan presentation or something like that around our budget. I don't know how else to do it, but I think that having this written in a way that it looks like we're putting forth a warrant for this year is going to not be received well.
Something that occurs to me now, probably should have occurred to me before, is that the other piece that we would have to work out is procedure with the moderator. I mean, typically, mm-hmm. if we're going to vote to take no action, or the committee's going to recommend no action on an article we put forward, I think actually those get rolled up in the consent, or whatever they call it, the consent agenda at the beginning, which is always a popular item anyway.
They probably wouldn't expect you to be speaking to it.
Exactly.
Well, and would he give you any discussion?
To establish the moderator, have somebody go up to the microphone to say, the committee's recommending no action, but we want to make a presentation.
Yeah. Could you have a
no action,
can we have a half hour with some slides?
Could you have a sheet with FAQs and just leave it on the table so people could grab it?
People grab everything on their way. Yeah.
Even if it is not in the warrant, it could be like an informational thing, so you at least
That we have to get separate permission for. But, you know, I mean, this is really good because I honestly, several of these points I hadn't thought of when we talked about it at the meeting.
Apparently I hadn't either.
Yeah, so, I mean, it definitely is a different approach that we haven't taken before, and maybe it isn't a productive one. I definitely thought it was worth considering, like you have an opinion about it
No, that's fine. I think it's definitely worthy of discussion, but my other concern would be if, just given the length of town meeting often, if we take up time on something that is not going to, we're not intending to move forward, or people going to be annoyed.
Right.
I was thinking that too.
Yeah.
Just the use of the clock.
And again, this is the thought process. The precursor to all of this, obviously, with the ballot question, was a mere mention of the field at a Board of Selectmen meeting that caused a lot of uninformed discussion by just a few members of that one committee. And so do we risk having a really high-level presentation that causes a whole bunch of people to go to the microphone and talk negatively and put a bad taste in everybody's mouth about it?
Well, yeah. I mean, I think you'd be better served actually presenting to the Board of Selectmen at a meeting there's going to be a presentation to the school committee, obviously, and the Board of Selectmen are going to want to know what the school committee's vote is on that. And whenever that meeting happens, you know, it happens. But I feel like, you know, you have more press following the Board of Selectmen meeting. The Board of Selectmen meeting was, you're right, where this kind of blew up a bit, and you would be able to inform those members as well that were uninformed at the time, and you'd have more of an audience there. They certainly have more of an audience than school committee meetings, so that might just be a better way of going about it. Mm-hmm. It's not as widespread of an audience as you have at town meeting, but I also agree with Nancy. One of my first thoughts were people are like wanting to move things along, and that's going to feel like a time waster, and I just don't know, like, the preemptive review isn't going to demonstrate what you're going to end up doing. And I agree with you procedurally, John. I don't know that you're going to get the opportunity.
Yeah. Well, it sounds like it probably isn't, but I think this was a great discussion. I mean,
maybe if you present to the Board of Selectmen, they'll write an article with that information in it. That would get the distribution.
Yeah, I mean, it's certainly not the only communication opportunity open to us. So it just was one, and it's kind of sounding more and more like it's probably not a productive one.
Yeah, especially since we actually will have warrant articles, and if we burn them early, then...
Don't worry.
Right. So the motion before us was actually to remove the athletic field warrant article, so I don't know if that motion's changing at this point or...
I don't like it.
Okay. Does we need any more discussion tonight? Okay. Then at this time I would seek a motion to vote to remove the athletic field warrant article from the May 2017 town meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Cavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, and it's unanimous and so carries. At this point, I did see Susan? Mrs. Rathermick. I'm going to say your last name wrong because I'm
Mick.
Mick. Mm-hmm. Rathermick. Arrived, so we'd like to jump back up to new business letter A and invite our new director of finance and operations appointment to join us.
New Ralph.
I don't think she wants to call me call that. Hi, welcome, Susan.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Yes.
Welcome.
Thanks.
Congratulations.
Now
you have to come
all the way around.
Right.
So good to see you again.
Do you
want to
vote first and then?
Oh,
we
right.
Oh, yeah. Congratulations.
I apologize. Thanks, Dr. McLeod. I should have talked about procedural. So, Dr. did you want to give us our consideration?
Definitely. So, after... I had to check my calendar because it felt like last week, but it's been a couple of weeks since you were here, sitting in a much more awkward position. You know, John thought
table.
We should have like a spotlight on you, where you had just a very successful interview. And as a result of successful contract negotiations with Susan Rathermick for the position of Director of Finance and Operations, she is here tonight for your vote.
Fabulous. So at this time, we have a motion before us to appoint Susan Rathermick to the position of Director of Finance and Operations effective July 1st, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Cavanaugh. Any discussion? All right. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. And it's unanimous. And
okay,
so carries.
Now welcome.
Now welcome.
And I am so upset that I won't have the opportunity to work with you, but I was thrilled that... That decision was made, so everyone's very excited.
And I was just going to thank you for coming out again tonight on this rainy night. It's just always it's exciting. We're excited. It's been a long process. Ralph's excited, although this is his excited face. I actually know you're going to be at a conference coming up, and we have planned time for transition for the two of you, which we're really pleased that Mr. Dumas agreed to do, because I think it's going to just be a smooth, seamless transition. And we're just, I want to welcome you and tell you how excited we are to have you join our team.
Well, thank you. Thank you, everyone. So it's an honor, and I'm excited as well. So I appreciate the long process because it is an important position to make sure that the fit is right for both sides. So I appreciate it.
Great.
Can I just say
something? Oh yes, Ralph. Of course.
Did you bring your clock?
He's
no,
reset it.
It's been reset.
I thought it couldn't be reset.
We had a discussion.
That's very exciting.
He looked up the instructions
I did want
on Google.
Susan to know that I have started to fulfill my promise. I've been cleaning the office for the last 2 days.
Wow. Oh, wow.
Discarding some old information that I could get rid of under the public records retention.
I was going to ask that question. Were you
like,
records retention law?
I know.
I took care of that.
And that was also frightening me because it's only April 6th.
Yeah, I was like,
and so I'm like, how much does he have to clean out of this office?
When was the last time you were in his office?
There's a lot of cars.
Years worth of old bid material that we don't need to keep and stuff like that. So congratulations. I'm really glad, as I told you before, that the board made the selection that they did. And I'm sure we'll have a good time together in the month of July. And any time between now and then, you know, I can be available as well. And I'll see you next Thursday.
Yes, thank you.
And when I asked Susan, you know, do you have any questions? Is there anything, you know, that you need from us? She said, I'd really like a copy of the budget. I'm like, okay.
Fair enough.
Ralph has already made sure that she has a copy of the budget. And I know how much she has to do to finish up all the things that she wants to do in the district that you're currently working
Correct.
In. So I appreciate that you're already thinking of us.
Yes.
Well, thank you.
Yes, great. Well, be thinking of us on May 1st when we get everything passed.
Yes.
Then it will be
Well, you're
the
welcome
official
to join us on May 1st.
Yeah. You can sit with me as a non-resident.
I don't know if I would force that.
Second, maybe third.
Yeah. God help us. But thank you very much, and especially for coming out today, because I'm looking out the windows out there, and I'm like, oh, it's a nightmare.
Yeah, it's not pretty.
We don't have good luck when we bring you those nights. The weather.
Snowstorms, storms, a couple inches. So hopefully we'll get better.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
All right.
Great. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Safe travels. Take care. So now we have a bevy of field trips.
Bevy.
A gaggle. Yeah, I don't know what four counts as, but it's a lot. So we first up, Dr. McLeod, we have the overnight travel for the varsity volleyball team.
Is that right?
Yep.
Okay.
So they are, this is an intent to travel. It won't take place until the fall, and so they'll come back for a final travel recommendation. They're scheduled to play in a volleyball classic tournament on Monday and have been invited to attend a reception the evening before. So they would be traveling on the Sunday and playing on the Monday being a holiday. So I am seeking your approval. I'm recommending, as did Evan, that this initial approval be approved. It allows them to move forward with their planning.
Any questions, discussion? All right, the motion before us, seek a motion to approve the initial overnight travel request for the varsity volleyball team to travel to the International Volleyball Hall of Fame and Volleyball Classic Tournament in Holyoke, Massachusetts on October 8th, returning on October 9th, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Kavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes. Yes, and it's unanimous, and so carries. Our next one.
And next, if we could invite Mr. Bishop and Mr. Scott back up.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Mr. Scott, Mr. Bishop.
I'd like to do a little preamble on this one, if we could. I have not yet made a recommendation for the very reason that this is an unusual request in that it does involve the students missing 4 days of school. The preamble is that, you know, part of Mr. Scott's enthusiasm, and as I think back, as we've worked together over the past few years, we've really done a lot to clean up our travel recommendations and looking at this very seriously. This is not a rubber stamp by any means. School committee, it's your job to approve and not approve. It's mine to recommend, as well as the principal of the building. In this case, this is a culminating event because the kids did so well at the precursor event. And they won. Or they qualified.
They did very well, yeah.
And I'm going to turn it over in just a sec to you. But before I do, I just wanted to say that, you know, Evan and I have had conversations moving forward about, you know, let's look at the entire potential of participating in something, because we don't want to put the school committee in a position of having to squelch something that the kids are really excited about. And that was never the intent, because obviously if the kids are going to be missing school, they're going to be required to make up whatever they miss. And they're also going to have their parents' permission to participate. So I've left it. It's kind of unusual to leave it not recommended at this point, only because I knew that the school committee would have questions.
Sure.
I wanted to give you an opportunity to, first of all, you know, give an overview of the opportunity for the kids.
Sure.
And as you said earlier, it's all about the kids. And then give an opportunity for the school committee to ask questions.
Sure.
So I'll turn it over to the two of you.
Okay. So I'm imagining we have three field trips that we're approaching you with tonight. The first one that was mentioned is the Business Professionals of America Club at the high school. This is this club that started last year. First, before I get into it, I do want to just thank a few people that have helped us out. I'd like to thank the school committee, first of all, for supporting us last year and also this year. Dr. McLeod, Dr. Kavanaugh, Megan Cox, who's always shuffling all of our paperwork and keeping me organized. Also, the building administrators, this is on behalf of all of the field trips that we're coming forward with tonight. At the middle school, we have Alan, Ann, Mary Ellen, and their support team of Rita and Lori. Also, I'd like to thank the administrators at the high school with Evan, Justin, Josh, and the support team of Leslie, Cindy, and Donna, who again keep me organized. Also to Ashok. Ashok has done a great job with outfitting the students with the technological tools that they need to be successful. And I'd also like to thank Ralph Dumas. Ralph took the time over the summer. We coordinated and through a few emails, and Ralph took the ball and ran with it and obtained a tax exemption certificate for the state of Florida, which would save the students $1,300 in room and board taxes. So I thought that was exceptional. The kids were really happy recently when I gave them the final figure, and they were very excited. So those are some folks there. And then also with regards to fundraising, the HPTA stepped up to help support the students' national run with BPA. We had Athletic Director King. She stepped forward and provided some 50-50 opportunities. The parents have helped organize fundraising. And also some private donors have stepped forward to support the program. So overall, it's been a real community effort. And I'm very thankful for that because, you know, on my end, I get very busy. As you said earlier, I get pretty busy. But without all these people helping out, it just wouldn't be possible. So thank you. So I'll go straight into the BPA trip. What happens is we had 19 students attend the State Leadership Conference in Framingham. And in Framingham, we had 15 students qualify and able to attend the National Leadership Conference in Florida, which is in May. Those events that they participated in, I handed out an article that's coming up in the Hopkinton Independent, and the results are listed within, and also some student testimonials with regards to why they are involved in these things. Because although there are no students here, I really believe in the students voicing their thoughts on what they do and letting them speak for themselves. But the trip moving forward is a great opportunity for these students. For a lot of these students, this is their sport. You know, you talk about athletic fields and things like that. Their athletic field is in the classroom. And it's interesting, I used to coach sports. And I used to coach sports at a decent level, and we had good teams, and we'd win big games. And you'd see the kids get really excited and jumping around on the ice or on the lacrosse field or whatever it was. And you'd go, wow, these kids are really pumped up about this. It's awesome to see students as excited about academics. And the time they put into it exceeds well beyond anything I've seen in athletics from my coaching standpoint. And so when you see these students succeed, it really is exciting. And to the point where we had some of the students, when they won their awards at the State Leadership Conference, previously they had said, oh, we don't think we want to go because the prom is that week. And I said, well, that's okay. I said, if you change your mind, you let me know, because I've seen this before. Students, when they put a lot of time into things, they get vested, they take interest in it, and they get really excited. So I'm sitting there, and I'm taking pictures of the kids as they go up and get their awards, and one of the kids from the news broadcast team came up, and he goes, hey, Mr. Scott, can we go? I said, I thought you guys were going to prom. And they said, oh, no, we want to go. We want to go. We want to compete. And I said, okay. I said, that's great. So it's really exciting to see the kids take on something that's a lot of work, put in the time, and see the rewards for their hard work. So a lot of interesting things about it with regards to recently I had gone over to a meeting that one of the students had arranged at a Starbucks. I really didn't feel comfortable with this, so I said I'll attend. So I went over on a Sunday morning to a Starbucks, and they met with a person that one of their parents works with in global industry. And they met with this person, and you would have thought that you were sitting at a board for a business. These students are so professional and were so well prepared. They asked great questions. And coming out of it was very interesting. They developed a conversation with this person, and the person said, oh, you're developing a project for Thailand. And the student said, yes, yeah, this, our proposal for this business project is we want to develop an ethanol plant in Thailand. And he said, you know what? In our company, we have a COO that operates out of Thailand. Would you like to learn about Thailand and their culture and how the business should operate in Thailand? And I'm sitting there going, wow, this is, like, really awesome. So the kids, you know, they've been in touch with Thailand, and they're actually learning about how to set up a business overseas. So those are the types of experiences I've seen that are really interesting. Other things that are really interesting are, you know, emailing over and getting cooperation from Kim Palnick at HR and taking the time to do interviews with students, and also in the building here, Justin and Josh sat down and took the time to do interviews with the students. Also taking the video production team. That spiraled. It was crazy. I got them in touch with a friend of mine at the state police. They're doing a tire safety video. That person then hooked them into Bridgestone Tires. They talked to an engineer there in Ohio. Then they spun off. They got a person at Cooper Tire. Then they contacted somebody at the youth safety organization. They worked with them. So the contacts that these students are making are far beyond anything that is normal within the classroom or even sometimes outside the classroom. We take it to the next level. And the best way that I could summarize it is I have a student that's going for his PhD right now, and I asked him one time, I said, what do you think of that BPA program we ran? And he said, Mr. Scott, he goes, that was the most real fake thing I ever did in high school. And I said, all right, Timmy. I said, that's good. We'll keep doing it. So those are the things that I see that are really special for the kids. There's an interesting article there for the Independent. And I remember last year when I started this, I said, a student named Phoebe Lynn, I said, Phoebe, do you have any interest in participating in this? And she said, will it help me get into college? Will it look good on my resume? And I said, I'm going to answer that honestly, I said, but you're going to find out there's other reasons. I said, yes, it will help you get into college. It'll look good on your resume. I said, but there'll be other reasons that you soon gravitate towards as to why you would do this. And I was excited to see she responded to the writer of that story. And she went way beyond her resume, way beyond college application. It became a big part of her high school career. It became a big part of who she will be in the future. And so when I see those results, that's why I do this. Because, you know, it takes a lot of time on my end as well. And I always tell my wife that as long as the kids are interested and they get a lot of value out of it, I'll continue to do it. And so far that's been the case. So that's a little bit of the background about the club and why we do it.
Go ahead. So let's get into some specifics about this particular trip, Doug.
Sure.
And I know the school committee has had it in the packet.
Sure.
So we probably could move into questions.
Okay. Sure.
Okay.
Go ahead, Nancy. I can see you're about to ask.
Well, my question isn't actually directly for you. It's really more directed to Mr. Bishop, but what is the expectation for the students with regards to when missed work? It would be a lot, I'm thinking of the stress, to make up that kind of work. I don't know that we have a policy directly related to missing school for a field trip.
We don't, and I feel like, you know, and I think Dr. McLeod mentioned at the beginning, we've taken our our trips very seriously, and we've looked at them to prohibit students from missing too much class time. But I do feel that there are certain opportunities, in my opinion, that are worth missing some class time every once in a while, and this is one of them. And so the kids know about it. They're good students. The teachers will know about their absence, and they're expected to make up the work. We don't have a specific policy of turnaround time that they have to make the work up in 48 hours or whatever it is. But the students know, like, by taking part in this, that they're going to have to work extra hard outside to be able to make up the work that they're going to miss. And to kind of go with the follow-up on the prom, we do have a number of juniors in this group, and so we're going to allow them to – excuse me. Yeah, juniors. We're going to allow them to attend the prom next year as seniors. To the
well, that's
so they won't miss
that's
their opportunity
nice.
To go to the prom. But and that, to me, hearing from some students that they would go down to this opportunity in lieu of one of the bigger opportunities in prom that they have here speaks volumes of how important this is for some of our students.
It sounds like it is something that could be impactful on these kids long beyond when they leave the halls of the school.
Yeah. I mean, I think there's no question that this is an outstanding opportunity for students. Mm-hmm. I'm grateful to you for being here, because when I read through the application, I did not understand from the application that this was something that that they have qualified for and earned.
Sure.
That gives me a greater level of comfort in that. Just from a process standpoint, because not that I don't think it would be a good opportunity anyway, but typically we haven't approved absences from school for this amount of time for a trip. However, we certainly have done that for kids that win the science fair or move on in a progression, even in sports. And I'm sure many of your students, knowing the students here, are also athletes and involved in many other science fairs and all kinds of other things, MICA. So that gives me greater comfort. That said, I think what Dr. McLeod said really resonated with me, which is in terms of, I don't know what kinds of different options there are for these competitions or tournaments, but seeing the end, all of the steps along the way and what those dates are, I think is important, because I also assume, particularly because you have juniors, that several of them are in AP classes. Mm-hmm. APs are going to be right when they get back, so they're missing prep time. And while they may make up their classwork, there's a lot there that is, you know, I mean, it certainly speaks volumes to the impact and value that this experience has for those students and their families. I mean, I think that's very clear, and I loved everything that you said about how across the board, across the district, across the high school, people are working to support these kids to get there. So I think it's a very rich program, and I think it's a tremendous opportunity. I definitely have a concern going forward in the future if a lot of these types of opportunities, if there are opportunities that we can select or pursue that don't impact their school time, particularly in the spring when they have APs and that kind of thing. I would have greater comfort with those going forward, but I certainly don't think that that's a reason to deny this trip this year. I think this is an outstanding opportunity. They've clearly earned it. They've worked very hard to get it. I guess my only request is maybe they come and tell us about it after.
Yeah, I'd be
glad
to
hear how it went, and they sound very entrepreneurial, and we were saying at the beginning, this is like the best meeting when we start out with all these celebrations and about the kids. So that's a long-winded way of saying it works for me. But.
Okay.
Is in this, I may have missed this in the packet, but is there financial aid available for kids who can't make the cost of?
Yeah, we've raised funds through fundraising efforts that the students have conducted. HPTA has contributed. We also have had some private donors, and I have worked with a student to accommodate.
That's great. I love how I think this is a great example back from the beginning of the meeting, talking about how student-centered you are, and it seems very well thought out.
Thank you. Yeah, and this is something I've done for 14 years. Since I started teaching. And again, it's something that I've seen that has had high value for students. And with regards to the AP exams, I've tried to be as thoughtful as I can in advance, and I've worked with guidance to establish alternative dates that are comfortable for students. And
I'll proctor them if I need to sit down and proctor them. I'll be glad to. But the students have, well in advance, made those arrangements.
I mean, it's piling on at this point, but I think missing this much school, I think Dr. McLeod, the way you brought this forward for consideration is makes a lot of sense. We need to handle this differently than probably we handle the consideration of a overnight trip over a vacation, but I think you need to handle these things on their merits, and this clearly, in my mind, merits the experience is going to be worth the work that's going to be missed or need to be made up. So I'm extremely supportive of it.
And we had some kids, I don't know if we can even call them kids, some high school students who came in who had gone for it in a science fair, and just the projects that they're working on, it's the same kind of thing. Like, there's no way I would have had the ability to do something called economic research when I was in high school. Like, it's just so impressive what these kids are working on these days.
She was very good, and she took the initiative. We set up a meeting with Norman Kamalu, the town manager, and she had a two-hour meeting with him about the economic impact of, you know, legislative decisions at multiple levels. It was pretty interesting, and she sent me her submission for the national conference the other day, and she said, I think she said something like, "I'm not going to lie, I'm stoked. I did a really good job on this."
And I said, "That's awesome."
I said, "Great." So again, It's like the fist pump of academics, you know what I mean?
So I liked how you said it was their sport.
It is their sport. I say that because the first time I ever did this 14 years ago, I had a parent approach me, and it just hit me. I was a young teacher at the time. I didn't really understand what I was doing. I just said, well, we're doing this really nice thing for kids. And the father pulled me aside, and he said, "I want you to understand, this is the only thing my son does. This is all that he does, and this means everything to him." And I was like, wow. You know, I didn't realize what an impact it has. And it's not that way for every kid. I think, you know, some kids have other things. But I've seen this be a game changer for a lot of kids.
Yeah. I just wish I had had the ability to think on this level.
Me too.
Well, I mean,
so to encourage that and to show how important it is to the school and
And, I mean, outside the context even of this final, you know, culminating experience, the experience all the way along is, I really appreciate how much you're doing to provide the kids with opportunities in the real world. I mean, we say all the time this is a community that is rich in resources, not necessarily financially all the time, but in terms of the people who live and work in this community. And so the connections that you're helping the students make, which are real-world connections and a model for how they're going to continue on in their life, navigating jobs and careers and everything else, is really tremendous. So, I mean, just listening to all of that as part of this presentation, you know, I'm going to go home and encourage my daughter to sign up for next year. But this is a remarkable opportunity, I think, the whole thing.
So in the interest of time, I'm not going to repeat what my four colleagues have so ably communicated, but I also am very supportive of this. So at this time, I would seek a motion to approve the request for the Business Professionals of America Club to travel to Orlando, Florida on May 9, 2017, returning May 14, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Cavanaugh, seconded by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
And it's unanimous and so carries. So before, I would have commented on this before, but I didn't want it to seem like it was tainting my vote.
Sure.
But I will be leaving the committee in May, and I would say that, so I work at a public company in Marlboro called Hologic, which is a med device company. I'm a corporate counsel for all of their operations team. So I work globally with operations and manufacturing. So if for any reason any of your students need another area to talk to somebody, I'd be more than happy to be a mentor for that group because it sounds fabulous. And what you're describing in terms of their interviewing executives and people at that level, for one thing, two executives in my company live in Hopkinton, one being the CFO. And so I just what you're describing is exactly what we're looking for in people starting out, and having those skills as young as 16 and 17 is amazing, because usually it takes years to even figure it out after college.
Yeah.
So I certainly would love to take part in it at any time. If you need anybody, certainly can reach out.
Trust me, I follow through. No, it is, and it's really a big part of our mission as our department was, when we set out, it was in my job description when I was hired, was get the kids out and compete and make ties to the community and create real situations for kids. And that's just a huge part of this. And I said about the same thing. When I sat there and I saw the kids start communicating with someone in Thailand, I'm going, man, I'm like, I don't even think I went to New Hampshire when I was in Thailand. You called on a payphone. You know, I'm like, these kids are really, this is a really awesome experience. So thank you. Yeah.
Congratulations. So we have another field trip request from you both, which,
two more.
Yes. Yep, this one is relation to the Robotics Club in Louisville, Kentucky.
Yeah.
Feel free.
Hit it.
No.
Okay. All right. So we're in our first year of a new robotics program at the high school. It's a twofold program where we have the team robotics class and we have the club after school. The two groups focus on the same competition, which is the VEX competition. So this year we've had, I think we had about 30 students involved. 11 females, which is a huge increase from past years of robotics experiences here at the high school. And the students did very well. We had 5 teams. They went off to 5 competitions throughout the year. 4 out of the 5 qualified for the Southern New England Regionals, which was up at Quinsigamon in Worcester. And we had our 5 teams compete against, they were in a field of 95 from Southern New England, which was Mass, Connecticut, in Rhode Island. So out of the 95, one of our teams was selected through their for what's called a design award. So they're one of 15 teams to make it out of Southern New England to go down to Kentucky to compete. They were selected on their team interview, which I can thank Evan and Josh and Justin for coming through, and also Dr. Kavanaugh came through and did some practice runs with them this year. And also for their engineering their engineering notebook. And through those things, they accrued points, and they came out on top. So they were selected to go. So the students have been working hard. All the kids, it's actually been pretty neat. All the kids pulled together, and they're all helping this one team prepare for Worlds. We had a scrimmage in here last Saturday with Blackstone, Framingham, and a group from Marlboro, and the kids worked through some problems. They're going to do it again Tuesday with those same people coming in to just test things out. And then we get on a bus, and we go on a long ride to Kentucky on the 18th. Look, isn't that so nice? Yeah. So on the 18th, we get on a bus, and we go to town. We stop along the way because the bus driver can only drive for 10 hours at a pop, and we stay in PA overnight at a hotel, and then we continue on the next morning. We finish up in Kentucky, and everybody's welcome to come with me. Then we go down, and but when they get there, it'll be worth it because they'll be competing against 30 plus countries from around the world. It's a really neat experience. I saw this with the middle school kids last year where they get paired up with teams from Australia, New Zealand, China. You'll see all sorts of teams, you know, from Canada, wherever, and all across the United States. And they compete for multiple days. And then they wrap it up on Saturday. We go to bed. We get up the next day. And we travel back in the same process that we started. And we make our way back, which is actually, to be honest with you, easier than flying with robots. I've done that in the past. And getting through TSA with batteries and chargers and all sorts of things can get pretty exciting. So we're better off to use the bus. And we're doing that through Quinsigamon's organizing the bus for us. There's a robot consortium out of Worcester. And what they do is they bring in some funding to help offset some of the costs for that, which is nice. So that's kind of it in a nutshell, and I'll be glad to answer any questions that you may have.
Any questions?
Well, this is sort of a question for both.
Sure.
So you're going down with the high school students.
I am.
They are coming home before you.
No.
So their trip ends, they return April 24th, but the middle school students?
They go down after. It's staggered. The middle school goes down
April 22nd.
And they come back.
So that's 25th. In the middle.
We get back on the Monday at like noon from Kentucky. So the high school students and I get back on the Monday. And the middle school students with their teacher, Amy Borges, and each middle school student will travel with a parent, are going down on the Sunday. And I believe they get back on the Tuesday, late Tuesday.
Oh, so you are not, okay, I was assuming
my wife's
back.
Very patient.
Okay, all right. I was trying to figure
trying
out
to be good.
If you yeah. there were two of you. All right,
yeah,
so
no,
she's
yeah.
leading the trip.
Yeah, she's leading
school.
The middle
I understand.
School
okay,
yeah.
thank you. That's less
I just,
confusing.
I couldn't do both.
No, I should have read that more.
Yeah, no, that's
now
okay.
I can see that. Yeah, okay.
I just couldn't do both. It's asking a lot of my family, so I have to kind of do it to the best I can.
Yeah. An impressive commitment that this is also your April vacation that you will be traveling.
Oh, yeah. Traveling. No, I always say if the kids didn't enjoy it, I wouldn't do it. So they enjoy it. So it's worth doing. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay. So at this time, I would seek a motion to approve the overnight travel request for the High School Honors Team Robotics Club to travel to Louisville, Kentucky on April 18th, 2017, returning on April 24th, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Kavanaugh, second by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes, and it's unanimous and so carries.
Thank you.
And we'll move on to the middle school robotics trip, which we pretty much just heard
yeah.
most of
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
Is there anything different from middle schoolers other than
they're
you're not going?
They're smarter than we are. They're flying.
Oh, okay.
They're smarter than we are.
Yeah. Oh, they're flying.
They're flying.
The parent
and student are going together. That's the requirement on that trip.
Gotcha.
Because the students are a bit younger.
All right. Any questions?
I mean, I'll just, you know, this one they are missing 2 days of school right after the vacation. So, you know, going forward, I hope we can find trips that don't impact that. I think it's a little less concerning at the middle school level than at the high school, but just a consideration for the future.
What I'll do in the future is I'll provide the forecasted dates well ahead of time.
Yeah, that'd be great.
And but please understand I have no control over.
No, I know. And I don't know how many options there are, but just in general, that historically has been the present. And I'm just... It isn't that I don't think all of these are outstanding opportunities, but I also am trying to be mindful that there have been trips that have been rejected in the past for that reason, and so I'm just trying to not all things are – they're not all apples to apples, but I am also trying to be mindful that we hold everybody to – you know, we apply the same rules. So
sure.
I don't want to ding this at all or punish it, but just as a consideration going forward.
Yeah, and it's a situation where I understand where you're coming from and it's also something that I think if you take a look at it I understand that they're consecutive days. But if you tally up other events, whether it be sports or academic events that are occurring, sometimes they trickle throughout, whereas this is consecutive. And I think that's where it comes across a little bit differently, where you see it as consecutive days instead of, you know, 5 days across the year, it's four in a row. So it's just a note of that. Yeah.
I'd like to also add for the school committee's information that this an original request came across my desk on March the 6th. So although it feels like, well, we're approving something and they've already got their tickets, there was, as Doug pointed out, a lot of back and forth with Megan. Doug is new to the process.
Yeah.
We're very, as I said, this is not a rubber stamp. So some of the back and forth that was going on between my office and the high school was gathering more information because I had questions. So that when it came to you, it was a complete packet. So although, you know, it feels that way because, well, this is like just about to happen, And you would typically have had more notifications so that you actually could weigh in. I just want to reinforce that this is something that's been a learning curve for Doug, and I think that your feedback has been well taken.
Yeah, I appreciate your support. Valuable. I don't have any problem with these.
I'll provide the full calendar in advance. Yeah.
No, that's awesome.
That'll help out.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Are you able to transport their robot?
Ooh, the middle school's robot?
I was thinking of them going through the TSA with
Yeah, those are a little different. They're smaller.
Okay.
And the plan is to break them up break up the parts and the components into smaller parts and have each student bring, like, a component. Yeah. So
that's team.
Yeah.
Teamwork.
So just for TSA.
It's like, let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go.
Nothing. No luggage gets lost.
Yeah, exactly.
Where's your component?
But the high school robot is considerably larger, so.
Oh, that's funny.
Just, it wouldn't be possible. Yeah, but that's how they're doing it.
All right. So I would seek a motion to approve the overnight travel request for the Middle School Robo Hillers Club to travel to Louisville, Kentucky on April 22nd, 2017, returning April 25th, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Cavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes, and it's unanimous and so carries. Thank you both. I think that was all.
Thank you very much
for
your support.
Thank you very much. And thank you for taking the time tonight. Although I think maybe you missed all the really bad rain.
It's not audible anymore.
So yeah, exactly.
Have an awesome bus trip.
It rained.
I'll tweet out the night of the 20th chance.
Yeah.
We're often jealous of these when we hear about them, but that one, the 10-hour bus trip.
We'll pay the price. Thank you.
So we have next on our agenda the YMCA renewal. I have to say, though, the rain like that, that's that loud, that's how it was on my wedding day.
What?
No one could hear our vows in the church, and the lights kept flashing.
Oh, no.
That's supposed to be
that
good
was
luck,
ridiculous.
Though.
I remember that. Yes.
Anyway, sorry. I digress.
Are we ready?
Yeah.
Okay. 2 years ago, we awarded a contract to the YMCA, and the way that it was put out to bid, it was a series of 3 one-year contracts because we were new to this. We wanted to make sure that you would have an opportunity at the end of every year to decide whether you wanted to move forward. So next year is the third year. And you can see the statistics there. There are 24% more students being served compared to last year. There's 128 of them being served for two or more days per week, and we've received $28,600 in rental income through the end of March, which is a 30% increase compared to last year, because the more kids they have, the higher the rent is. And I'd just like to point out to you that in years past, when we had kids borrow at the Elmwood School, I think we were getting $25,000. And so we're definitely making more money on this particular rental. So the YMCA is really, in my opinion, been good partners with us. And so I didn't hesitate to put together the recommendation along with Dr. McLeod to ask the school committee to exercise your option to renew the contract for the third year beginning in September of 2017.
Great. So I actually have a question, which is interesting, Meek, being that I have two students that utilize the program at the Elmwood School. But Dr. McLeod, have the principals at the schools voiced any concerns over the programs in Hopkins and Elmwood at all?
None at all.
Okay.
No.
Because I know they utilize a lot of their buildings.
Yeah. No. So. As Ralph said, they've been really good partners and very responsive to any concerns, but there haven't been any complaints brought to my attention.
Great. Any other questions?
So this is the third of 3 one-year contracts. So I'm asking you, but what's the plan for next year? Are we going to do are we thinking open bid process? Or do we have any thoughts on that?
Actually, legally, you have to put this out to public bid, or the way that we did it was an RFP, so that you're not simply awarding it to the renter who was offering you the most money. Mm-hmm. In the case of the YMCA, when the review process was done, the group who reviewed it, which included Dr. McLeod, determined that the YMCA program better served the needs of our kids in terms of what they were offering in terms of not only pricing but scholarships for free and reduced lunch students, as well as the way that they interact with our principals and teachers at the school.
Well, and I think they also, didn't they also really pinpoint the strategic plan? They, like, made an effort to really focus their, like, homework policy on the strategic plan and looking to partner with the schools on helping in that.
They'd actually like to be able to partner more, particularly around kids, helping them with homework and identifying areas where perhaps they can partner with classroom teachers. So that has not been kind of taken on as much as it might, just mainly because it's a communication piece that I'd like to look into more, because I think it's a real opportunity for students to get help before they go home, and for parents, busy parents who pick them up and have everything else that they need to do, to know that homework has already been completed and that there's been some assistance if needed, I think is a real benefit. I was also going to add that it's going to be a really great, exciting and interesting year, because we'll have the opportunity to also hold a program at the Marathon Elementary School. It's not rolling off my tongue yet. And then finally, Mr. Dumas and Mrs. Fitzpatrick have been looking at and talking with me about studying this whole question about daycare and transportation. And so those are all things that are mixed into this, the impact that it has on our transportation program, our dismissal process, all of those things we're going to be taking a careful look at once we get past town meeting and bring back some thoughts to the school committee. So those are all things that are timely in the sense of, you know, this being the end of the third year, the Marathon School having an opportunity for a program, and then really looking closely and giving providers plenty of notice if there's going to be a change in past practice around daycare transportation.
So this would, I would recommend that this be put out to bid, so to speak, earlier rather than later.
Like how, what's early?
I would say probably do it in December or January, so that you make a decision. Parents then have a lot of time to make their own plans.
And I don't disagree with you, Mr. Dumas. As a parent that utilizes programs and has used both programs in town, which really the two in-town main programs are Kidsborough and the YMCA, I know from being a parent at the Kidsborough program that they start asking for registrations in February, mm-hmm. and they won't hold your spot if you don't make a decision in that month. So the earlier you do it, the better in terms of solidifying your parents for the following year.
Okay.
And not forcing them to make a decision too early that then keeps them from choosing the program at the school. So, I mean, whoever's program it is. But
absolutely. And I just made a note that maybe we'll start looking at it in November even, Lori.
Yeah.
Yep.
You'll have to discuss that with New Ralph.
In terms of
Susan.
In terms of contractual.
She's
official
now.
I asked if we could call her that, but Lori's not going to call her.
In terms of, so we did this three-year contract because it was new. We wouldn't necessarily.
You had. There's no reason that you have
no
to.
Reason. We're just limited probably by the three-year.
Yes.
Contract. The legal limit.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Wasn't there some option around snow days too for parents that needed it? They would have.
They do
on
have options.
At the, yeah. So. Not that that really impacts us, but I thought that was a really, really nice option. Mm-hmm. Maybe both of them had that. I just remember that
they
in particular.
Both,
yeah,
they
stood
both
out
offer
me.
It. And the why, I mean, the thing that that our kids have enjoyed with it is that, like, on early dismissal days, they take the kids over to the Y East Street facility, and they get to utilize the entire campus over there. And they do, you know, field trips on school vacation weeks and school vacation days, like, you know, November when we had how many days off for Election Day and everything else. So they do a lot that's different. I mean, I'm not going to be part of the bidding process. So, but I mean, they definitely have a lot of opportunities there. And I think the interesting thing, too, is that any of the kids that utilize the Y camp in the summer
often a lot of the counselors are the same that are at the after-school program, so they get to know the kids really well. And they do give progress reports as to how the kids are doing in after-school program to the parents mid-year to kind of give you an idea. And they work with parents also just on even, like, behavior charts and things like that. That's been my experience. So I have been very pleased, and in fact, I was really concerned about how it would be to actually access the program, being that you have to typically call to get in the building because it's not like you have a code to get into a daycare building like you would, and that's not been an issue at all. So,
cool.
So that's just my personal experience, but anyway. All right. Does anyone have any other questions? Okay. Then at this time, I would seek a motion to approve the recommendation of the superintendent to renew the contract with the YMCA for a third year beginning in September 2017.
So moved.
Second.
A motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Kavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
And it's unanimous and so carries. And our next item is the school bus contract renewal.
So this is a contract that has a life of 5 years. It was approved at town meeting a couple of years ago that we could do that, and we don't have to refresh that. That's a standing authorization now that we can go out for a five-year contract. That wasn't specific for that particular procurement.
For simply for student transportation?
You can do that for anything, but you have to go to town meeting to get approval.
No, I know, but you said it's a standing approval.
Yes, it is.
So it's the standing approval is just for transportation?
Just for transportation.
That not with this particular company?
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. That was specific in the warrant article.
Gotcha.
Okay. So next year is year five. Last year, those of you who are here might remember that I actually put this back out to bid to see whether the option was in our best interest, and clearly the option was in our best interest. And knowing what's going on in the transportation bid world now in other districts, there's no reason to believe that this is still not in our best interest. One of the keys is item number two, which is the fuel adjustment clause. We have a base price in the contract of $4.17, which is a lot higher than the marketplace. So as a result, we get fuel de-escalator credits for the difference, and those can total, I think last year they totaled $35,000, and so that's savings to us. So if we put it back out to bid now, we would probably have a lower base price, and we run more risk of having to pay either pay escalator fees or to not be the beneficiary of the de-escalators, okay? Because it's never going to get to $4.17 during the last year of the contract unless something really strange happens economically. So in any case, I also want to point out that when we had to add the bus this year, I did end up in a negotiation with Mr. Connolly. On the price of that, he originally wanted full price, and I told him in no uncertain terms I would not agree to that, because I felt as though if I were to do that, then he would be taking none of the liability on for his drivers having driven on those prohibited roads, the causeway and a small bridge, for as long as they did, and I got him to agree, and so we didn't quite split the cost, but we're still going to pay $17,000 less in FY17 than he wanted. So we did have, I think he got like 55 and I got 45 of how it all worked out. So Mr. Connolly is not very well known for giving money up. And so I felt good about that. And I told him that we would be recommending that we exercise the final option year for them to provide school bus transportation for us for the for the 2017-18 school year. And so that's our recommendation.
Good work.
All right, there you go.
I'm just noting how Mr. Dumas has successfully set up the after-school program and transportation contracts to run out just after visits to leave these for his successor, who isn't here for this agenda item.
Exactly. And wasn't there a contract a couple of weeks ago, too?
Well, the teacher's contract.
Oh, the school lunch.
I mean,
lunch contract. There's absolutely. The teacher's contract.
Have fun, and, yeah. All of you. Yeah,
that clock is...
It worked pretty well, didn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well done.
Since we have the same timing as Ralph, we can't.
So I will, however, point out to you that, and to Susan, when we transition, that you better prepare for a price bump for the FY19 budget.
Mm, the transportation.
Yep.
What's the driver? What's going to be the driver of that, you think? Just the
It's only going to be one bid.
the contract negotiation isn't going to be much right. of a negotiation.
Yeah, that's a bid.
Your parking lot thing is going on, too, with their special permit. So
that will certainly help.
Yeah, your leverage is low.
Yep. So there's not a lot of competition in this field.
And that was driven, we thought, mostly by the fact that we don't have our own parking lot. Was that what the driver was, we thought, the last time we were looking at it?
Well, the parking lot will save money. When we put this out to bid 5 years ago, 4 years ago, I guess now, there actually was a second bid. It was Durham from the company that does Framingham. But there hasn't been a lot of second bids recently. They all sign a legally required document called the Certificate of Non-Collusion as part of the bid process. But when you only see one bid, you really do kind of have to wonder.
And we're not alone in...
No.
No. So that's the lot doesn't necessarily, not the driver.
Right.
Yeah.
I was talking more about the Ashland special permit that they're going to have to get to keep the buses where they currently are.
Yeah.
And what impact that might have.
Oh, no.
I wasn't talking about our parking lot, although that's...
If that costs Joe Connolly money, it will likely find its way into contracts, whether that's our contract and Ashland's contract, or whether he spreads that among all of his contracts. I really don't know.
Susan loves transportation, just saying.
Yeah, so. Yeah. We heard
She's
about that.
She's going to not be disappointed that this is where it is.
Yeah, this isn't the challenge, though. The challenge is bus stops.
Got it. Let's not go there tonight.
Alrighty. So at this time, if there's no more questions or discussion, I would seek a motion to approve the recommendation of the superintendent to renew the contract with Michael J. Connolly and Sons, Inc. for the 2017-2018 school year.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, second by Mrs. Cavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes. Yes, and it's unanimous and so carries. Wait, why is his name Joe if it's Michael J. Connolly?
Michael J. was his father.
Ah.
And he's 89 years old.
Gotcha.
Oh, my. So
Joe.
Maybe we should start a bus company.
Been in business for a long time.
Seriously.
Revenue and generator.
I do not have a bus. All right. The next item on the agenda is school committee policy IHBB extended school year. Dr. McLeod
and Nancy. So, yes, you're absolutely right, Lori, that this was actually a public records request from a member of CPAC who was interested in knowing what the school committee policy had to say with respect to extended school year. So that was the first time this question. When I asked Dr. Zaleski if that question had ever been posed to her, it had not. So I asked her to go and do some research, and what she'd found is that not only do we not have a policy, but neither do surrounding towns, by and large. Nancy, I don't know if you found the same.
I did, actually. That was when the figuring out the lettering of it, I was not able to find a comparable.
A comparable. And the one that is in the packet tonight is really from Newton. And had been over, they had legal counsel take a look at it. But as a couple of you have pointed out in comments to me, through me, I'm not sure that it adds anything other than to define what the purposes are as required by DESE and the IEP
for extended school year. And furthermore, the difficulty with calling out specifics, which is, I think, something that the parents were looking at some direction on with regards to transportation, is a student-by-student decision and wouldn't be really relevant or appropriate to include under policy. So it's here for your consideration as to whether or not you feel it's important to have an ASY policy, and also for your feedback if there are additional pieces that you want to be included or considered under this policy, as our practice has been to take it up in a public meeting. And so it has been shared through listserv. I know that Lori did get at least one response. And it's open now for discussion.
Yeah, so before we do discuss, let me give you the feedback that I've gotten from the community thus far. So we received an email from Kim Lee, who is a member of the CPAC and has met me as the liaison, and sent her message. And I'll just read it to you because it'll be easier than trying to I don't want to get in somebody's head and say the wrong thing, to be honest with you. So it says, "Hi, Lori. Thanks for taking the lead on this. To me, this proposed policy answers the who gets ESY question very well. Personally, the what is covered and at what intensity question has been the most problematic for us, as we have seen regression in performance in spite of attending for 3 years. Should the policy contain input on what is covered? Do service grid services continue? At what level? And who is responsible for the data collection / evaluation should someone move into town late in the year?" From the state FAQ webpage on ESY, and this is a quote, "Any decision regarding needed ESY programming must take into account the child's history of significant regression and limited recoupment capability. In other words, a child's team must look backwards and forward when considering the need for ESY programming," end quote. And there's another quote, "The principles of least restrictive environment apply to the provision of ESY services," which comes from an OSEP policy letter dated December 18, 1989. And then I have one more quote, which is, "It is reasonable for an extended school year IEP to concentrate on 1, the areas in which the child may experience regression, or 2, skills or programs that are not academic but are needed so that regression does not occur in academics." And then a citation is given. And I can forward this email to you all. I just wanted to have it out for discussion first. And then the last paragraph of her email states, "I'm sure that you and district council would be more equipped to interpret these judgments, but they seem to steer how ESY should be run. Thank you for the opportunity to provide feedback to the school committee. Best regards." And then, like I said, we all received a message from Mr. Johnson. I believe you all were copied. Yes, Dr. McLeod responded as she was addressed first. And there was a document provided to us in regards to ESY transportation.
Yeah, that wasn't really this policy, though. That was more about the CPAC meeting and the transportation issues.
Okay. And then I did not receive any other comments about the policy itself, although I did receive messages from CPAC asking about how to provide further comment to all of us, which there are 2 members of CPAC that are here that wanted to listen to our discussion, and I had informed them of our public comment opportunity at the meeting. And so there was also let them know also that, you know, after the meeting, if they had further questions and didn't want to speak a public comment or what have you, they could email them to us as well, because I was definitely under the impression that this was not something that was going to be voted tonight, because none of us had the opportunity to even discuss it. So it will certainly be up for revision, and obviously we had even had a yet to even have a discussion of the need for it or the not need for it. So those were all the public information that I had received on it. It is of great interest to the CPAC, I would say, in light of the fact that this is my interpretation of the last CPAC meeting, is that there was a lot of concern on the part of parents about
changes to the ESY program that are being made for this coming ESY school year. And Dr. McLeod can probably speak more to the actual changes if that's pertinent to the conversation, but I think the overall feeling was there wasn't a lot of understanding as to why the specific changes were being made and whether or not rights of their children were at all being impacted based on the changes that were being made, and whether or not a policy would protect from those changes. What I was trying to, in all of the questions that I received, the hard part for me was we as a school committee have a responsibility to set policy for the district, yet none of us are educators or skilled, especially in the area of special ed. And so in setting a policy, I feel like we would be setting a policy in regards to the requirements of the district and what we are to provide as a district for a program. But the intricacies of the program, we'd be ill-advised to have too many specifics in a policy, because that would lend itself more to me as a procedure that the administrative team and the specialists within the special ed program would be responsible for. My interpretation of the concern is that I don't and I could be wrong, and certainly at public comment, if I'm wrong and that gets brought up, I'm happy to be corrected. But my interpretation is that because there isn't a lot of documentation around what is to be included, that, you know, in terms of like what the administrative team has put out to the parents of students that may be in need of ESY services, that when the changes were made, it was like, well, we don't even know what we're actually entitled to because it's not written anywhere. So, you know, that's just my interpretation of where this all is stemming from. I don't necessarily disagree that an ESY policy is useful because of the fact that, to be quite honest with you, prior to me being a liaison, I didn't know what ESY stood for and what it actually was and what the purpose of it was. I've learned a lot in taking part in those meetings, but I just think that we as a committee have to be careful as to how much we're inserting ourselves into a process that's actually very personalized student to student. Mm-hmm. So that's where my take is on it. Mm-hmm. But I don't see the harm in defining it and what our requirements actually are, but a lot of our requirements are set by state law. So that's actually another question I had too, because like we definitely don't have any legal references in here, I didn't realize this was from Newton, but there have to be some legal requirements that we must be referencing somewhere. Uh-huh. So anyway, sorry, I'm taking up a lot of the discussion. That's just all the input I've had thus far, in the limited amount of time that I put any thought into it, and trying to decipher where our role is in it, because also some of these situations are so specific and specialized that we're not even entitled to that information as a committee. So that, you know, that's another difficulty in the situation. Sure.
I think this is a policy. I don't think is a bad idea to put out. I'm wondering if what parents are looking for is more of a handbook kind of a thing, that, and I don't know if such a thing exists that explains some of the services, whether or not not particular to their child, but some of the services that are being offered. For example, I know in the past they have done some yoga and some physical exercise type things, an explanation of what that would not be at this level with us, but that might go back to the to Karen to look at to see if that's appropriate or if that would be helpful to the parents to know what the purpose of some of it is, so that it doesn't come across as valued as an important part of their child's program and not being seen as just sort of an extra that's being added on. I know that was.
Can I respond to that?
Sure.
So, Nancy, I think that's a fabulous suggestion, on several levels. And as you were talking, I jotted down not only purpose and definition, but I think about families new to ESY, mm-hmm. families who have children in the program for the first time. And I also think about notification, for example. There have been concerns about when are parents going to be notified, whether or not their child has met the criteria for ESY. There are questions about data collection and expectations around regression. Or non-regression or recoupment. So I think defining all of those things in a handbook would be really reassuring to parents, and it feels like it would come then under a procedure reference, mm-hmm. which I know the I'm looking to see who was on that subcommittee.
I communicated with the MASC about
right,
the procedure does not have to be adopted here.
But there was a lot of work on the part of people, the school committee members doing policy work, who were working really hard to separate procedure from policy over the past few years. And I'll be really curious to hear from the CPAC parents whether or not that would be something that would really meet the questions that they've been having, you know, as a reference to the policy defining the legal requirements.
Well, certainly the CPAC parents will let you know, but I can say this. From my 2 years as liaison, the number one topic out of any issue that has arisen, mm-hmm. has been communication and information. Mm-hmm. And so the fact is, a handbook in and of itself, like the first thing when you said that word, I was like, that's genius. Because I think the problem is that there are no places to reference what's available and why is this being offered. And I think the other issue that I've become more aware of, and I'm certainly not an expert, but the fact is, like, your IEP meetings happen once a year. They're not always at the end of a school year. Right. So when decisions are being made on ESY, if you had your IEP meeting back in October, November, it's not really going to help the discussion for ESY for the coming summer, because you have to look at where the student's gotten in the school year. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I think answering some of those questions where you're not getting into specifics on a particular child, right. but giving some parameters around it would really be a much improved process to where it is right now. And I think the feeling of being in the dark all the time is really a big discomfort to a lot of these families.
Of course. I think one of the things, too, Dr. McLeod, you made reference to the efforts we've had over the past few years. I think most of us have been involved in that subcommittee at some point in terms of the policy review. One of the reasons why we've really strived to separate policy from procedure, and you know, and I think if we were to further look at this potential policy, one of the things I'd be interested in is getting those legal references mm-hmm. in here to see mm-hmm. what that actually looks like. Because I would remind the committee that we've had situations where we've had policies that I think were originally intended to communicate the procedures of the school district that have caused us to make decisions that we're not comfortable with for individual student issues because we're bound by the way the policy was written, even though we didn't necessarily think that in that case it was the best thing for the student.
Yeah.
I am absolutely supportive of whatever will help improve both the communication understanding on all of all parties, but that's my one caution as we go forward, is we've been in that situation where policy has actually bound us to make decisions that we weren't always comfortable with.
Correct.
And so if it is better solved by procedure and communication and a handbook, I think we should really strongly look to lean that way, because mm-hmm. I would hate to draft something that is incredibly well-intentioned that becomes an overly restrictive policy that mm-hmm. that ties the hands of a future committee.
I also like the fact, thank you, John, I also like the fact that in my mind I'm already thinking, you know, you approve the student handbooks and you approve the amendments to them. So this could just be another one of those annual, when there are changes that come to the school committee, if there are changes, and that we look at it on an ongoing basis within the changing needs of the community. So it kind of fits under that umbrella in my mind as well, mm-hmm. as far as coming to you.
Well, and I think that actually would have been a tremendous way of avoiding the transportation issue that arose this year with ESY, because that decision, I think, impacted budget.
and could have been something that we had a more in-depth conversation about. I mean, I felt in an awkward position during that meeting because I didn't appreciate what the changes had been myself, and it's not that they were brought to my attention on how they were communicated, but they didn't resonate with me, how drastic the change was, and especially the impact it was going to have to a lot of families. And I witnessed people realizing at the meeting what a drastic change some of those changes were and how they were going to impact their families over the summer. And I would have felt the same way, mm-hmm. because a lot of the changes really impacted a lot of working families. And I was thinking to myself, oh, dear God, that would have sent me into a tailspin. So I think that if it works the same way as the middle school and high school handbook did, and the school committee was able to weigh in or at least ask some questions, because I think we are getting feedback from the community and we do have more eyes and ears on what concerns are out there on the ground, where the people feel more comfortable potentially talking to us in certain circumstances in the administration, we can bring that lens to some of the changes that are being made and be able to maybe like even what happened tonight with the Warren article. Oh, I didn't think about it that mm-hmm. way. How is that going to impact the public? I think that's really our purpose, is to bring that lens of how is this going to impact? And so and it's not that I don't think that the administration thinks about those things, but sometimes it's the same thing as when you look at a piece of paper that you drafted and you've looked at it six times and you still miss the spelling error directly in front of your face. You can't always see what's in front of you. So that handbook piece and having that lens, I think, would really be really useful.
I agree. I think that is a great direction to go. I think having it, as you suggested, Dr. McLeod, be reviewed by the school committee each year adds a level of transparency and visibility across, you know, opens it up more broadly to the community. I think, you know, my preference is that we also do have the policy. I absolutely am on board with, you know, policies can't, there's almost never a one-size-fits-all solution that you can put in a policy that's more difficult to amend than a handbook or a procedure or anything else. But I do like, I did see reference in here to the deadline by which the ESY determination should be made each year. And I know, you know, just over the course of years, that's something that's been brought to my attention by several parents, that, you know, sometimes it doesn't happen on a certain schedule, and that, you know, it really is very challenging for families to plan. So I do like that there's at least that level of specificity in the policy. Additionally, I think having the legal references is it's standard in terms of what we do, but I think in particular it's very helpful. I had an experience today talking to somebody who was looking for some information that was on that she thought would be on our website and wasn't, and just was a moment that I think I'm having right now, which is, you know, there are a lot of things that happen that we may be aware of, and this is more probably in this case related to the administration than the school committee, that we don't even realize that people are out there looking for it and not able to find it on our website. So I really do think, in particular, this is a perfect example of, even though this isn't typical in other districts, I think this is an extra communication opportunity that for people who are new or, you know, have a question at midnight on a Tuesday, that there's some place they can go and look and start to get some understanding of what all of this, how it all works and where they can go with questions and concerns and whatnot. So I think the combined approach is outstanding. I probably could have said that shorter.
So it's funny that you mentioned that, Jean, because the only thing that I actually felt was missing in here is who do they go to in the district for questions, you know, like that.
Well, I think that's in our problems, school-related problems and concerns policy. Maybe that's a policy cross-reference that we should add in, or maybe there's something different that should be spelled out in this, but...
Oh, that's true.
You know, we do have that that's like my favorite policy. That's the one that I feel like I point people to the most. So I always feel like it should be cross-referenced often on a lot of these others.
Okay.
So, okay. People have been talking all around me. So I had a question just in general about extended school year and the approach that we take to extended school year. So if this is adopted from a different district, when we read this, this is how we see our program also?
It's all dictated by the regulations.
It all is. I know we talked about adding legal references, but really there's nothing above and beyond the legal put into words here.
Not that I have seen, no. Okay. We need to add the legal references. We need to cross-reference other policies.
Yeah, okay.
You finish your question.
So that's where I was going with this. So there's a lot of talk in here about, you know, regression and not wanting kids to have regression over the summer. But, you know, in talking to parents, I've heard, well, why aren't we trying to catch up in the summer? Why aren't we putting effort into attaining closer to grade level or, you know, making progress over the summer, closing the gap? And this doesn't reference closing the gap. It only references not falling behind. So when I read it, I thought, oh, that's weird. So we don't even make it a stated goal to continue the progress that has been made throughout the year. It's all about kind of just not going backwards. Mm-hmm. And so I had more of a fundamental question about our approach to ESY in that regard. And maybe, I don't know if this policy, if we do consider that a goal, this doesn't speak to it. If we don't consider it a goal, should it be a goal? So it was more around a fundamental question about what is our ESY goal? And then we talked about the handbook, which I really liked the idea of, because when I read this and I was like, I don't even know what this means. Like, I had to read it like five or six times. I was like, recoupment? What is recoupment? What is regression? Like, what is non-regression? And I had to read it a lot. And I'm like, if I was a new parent trying to figure out what ESY is, this is not going to help me. So a handbook would definitely help me, because that would be in more plain English with real examples. So that's kind of where I came at when I saw this policy. Like, I don't know if, and then I said, everything's just going to be in the IEP anyway, which is not going to be in a policy. So I didn't. Those were my kind of fundamental questions around here was, do we have goals of trying to close the gap more than just not regress?
So I love the question. So there's the goal and then there's the requirements, right? So Kelly, so I completely,
okay, I
the low bar is the requirement, the legal requirement, and kids are identified for ESY based on whether or not there's anticipated regression should they not get the program.
Sure.
But I couldn't agree with you more that it's a very low bar, that if the kids are in the program anyway, that we, of course, there's the requirement and then the expectation. The expectation is that we're providing a program, and I've said this last year at CPAC, and we worked with the director of CPAC to make sure that we had opportunities for conversation between teachers, the teacher of the ESY program and the current teacher, so that what has been happening for this child that's been successful can be continued in the summer. The challenge, so philosophically, absolutely.
Okay.
The challenge is this. The challenge is that when we make written expectations on goal achievement and we can't control attendance. So although the program is offered for 6 weeks, kids may attend for four of those 6 weeks because of family vacation, etc. And so I think that this discussion can certainly become and will certainly become, I'm going to take away from tonight's discussion a follow-up with Dr. Zaleski and Dan Mazur, Dan being the person who's running the program this summer, around what are the requirements and what are we putting in place for this transition between the current teacher and the program, whoever's going to be teaching that child in the summer. And then what are the goals for that child? Because if they're going to be coming for, whether they're coming for 4 weeks or 6 weeks and they're there for 4 hours, of course we want to make sure that that time is well spent for that child, and that we would hope that we could have more than just lack of regression and we could see some progress towards closing the gap.
Right.
So, but I think it's not something that can be stated through policy.
Okay, so this is really the...
the requirement.
So there's a new chapter in your handbook.
New chapter in the handbook.
There you go.
new chapter.
Well, and not only around expectations, but how do we make that happen?
Right.
Yeah. You know, and maybe it ends up being, you know, something that we budget for. We need to budget for transition mm-hmm. meetings. We have transition meetings between between schools when kids are going from second to third. I really have to process
first
it.
To
from
third
to fourth and fifth to sixth, or first to second. We have those transition meetings. Why wouldn't we have transition meetings mm-hmm. for children who are going into the ESY program between their classroom teacher and whoever's going to be teaching them in the summer, the ESY teacher? So, you know, that's something that we could certainly budget for.
Right.
But it's not to say that we don't have some of those expectations in place right now, and that doesn't need to wait for a handbook to tell us that we should be having these conversations for this year's program. Mm-hmm. I would suggest that the handbook is work that's going to take some time and probably be developed over the summer. I don't know if the school committee wants to hold back on that its development before moving. Your decision on policy, I know clearly that this is coming back at least for next week, or if you want to wait to adopt it until the handbook is complete. So that's a bigger question.
I think for me personally, I'd like to, you said the next CPAC meeting is May 16th. I'd really like to get some response and reaction from the parents. I mean, if we're missing the mark here, you know, why are we wasting our time, or why are we doing something that's not suiting uh-huh. the needs that they're trying to express to us? So, I mean, to me, this isn't a policy that we have now. I think it's a very good conversation that's gotten started. I don't want to try to force a timeline that's going to inhibit that. So I would like to sort of see it develop based on what the kind of the response is that we get from this start that we're making, and what the input is in terms of how it's meeting their needs, and then go from there. I mean, typically we have a policy for at least two, if not three, readings, and so we can plan that accordingly. So it seems like things, concerns have primarily been resolved for this summer, or at least this isn't going to fix whatever is lingering. So we don't have to get this done tomorrow.
So I would not say that things have been resolved.
Okay.
And I know that I've been in contact with individual families, and that I'm working with Dr. Zaleski on a more a stronger statement around. They're still kind of hanging out there what's okay. going to be happening for 2018. And so there's a follow-up piece that still has to happen for this summer.
Okay. Well, that was a bad assumption on my part, but it doesn't sound like the fix is this particular policy.
No.
Right.
No.
So
yeah,
I don't see a reason to rush the policy. I would like to see it develop mm-hmm. more organically with input from
Have ESY determinations to that point been communicated?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay, so that's not, we're not passing this so that.
No.
Okay, so that part has already been taken care of.
Yes.
Well, they're in process. I mean, it's just the beginning of April at this point, so have they all been?
They were supposed to be. I mean, my understanding from this being a problem in the past was that notification was supposed to be back in February.
Oh, okay.
But I could be wrong. Definitely.
So the one point I would make, and actually two, that I was going to bring up was that because our only public that is here are members of the board of the CPAC, I would recommend moving up public comment before we move on to after this item, but moving on to the next item, I would
sure.
recommend moving it up. If anyone else from the public shows up for the later time, we'll certainly
can have it.
Allow them.
Yeah.
If they come out at 9:40 in the rain, I'd be impressed. But the other piece I would state is that if you have another meeting to discuss the policy, you may want to invite a board member or two from CPAC to join the discussion so that you have your full informed. I mean, certainly would be informed by the next CPAC meeting, but I think that that would be a more collaborative discussion point. So that would be my suggestion.
Just a question about the program in general. Is there any collaboration that happens with Parks and Rec, with ESY, to do any inclusion with them?
None. Pretty definitive answer.
I just was curious.
Not that there couldn't be. That's a great idea. Another great idea.
You're full.
You may have nothing for the rest of the night.
She's tapped out. Yeah.
All right, so we're not making any decisions tonight. We've given some recommendations to Dr. McLeod. When would people like to see this on the next agenda item? Would you talking the end of May, the beginning of June? Like, what is the timeline that you're feeling on this?
So I know that you said that the handbook and that type of concept would take a little while to develop. I struggle with how we would get to a policy without that, because I think that the two need to go hand in hand in conjunction. Yeah. They don't conflict. One doesn't override the other, and we are developing both of these. So I would not, personally, I would not want to see the policy before we can see the handbook procedure, whatever we're going to call it. So I guess I'm sort of putting that back to that to you, I think what's a reasonable time frame.
And I, you know, say this on camera, as you know, I always will encourage parents who have followed the communication policy to bring their concerns forward. So I think if we can help individual families to get their questions answered for this summer and their concerns about their child's program individually, then I would suggest bringing this back in the fall, like early September, with a fully developed handbook. And inviting members of, that's a great suggestion, members of the board of CPAC to be here when we take it up next. I think that would, you know, that addresses the needs for this summer, but looks, gives us the time to look as we work through the summer and work collaboratively to put together a really thoughtful handbook.
Yeah, I mean, certainly like in your summer working session, you could add it to the calendar for early in September and work it out that way. I think that, I mean, to me, that's a reasonable idea.
Okay.
Any other comments?
I think that sounds good.
Okay. So we're not taking any action on the policy tonight, and we did agree to move up public comment. So ladies, if you did have anything you would want to comment on or provide questions or anything, right now would be the great time to do it. Not to put you on the spot.
But you do have to come up here. So
yeah. You have to come up to the mic.
Yeah.
Because you have to be on TV.
Actually, my son said, please don't be on camera. It's going to be like as the HQM videos come up in his Gmail. Sorry, Jake.
So all we ask with public comment is that you give your name and address, and then we do typically have a time period, and because we have a full agenda, I am going to have to keep you to 3 minutes each, so I apologize in advance. I know there's not other people here behind you, but at the same time, we have a packed agenda, so go right ahead.
Yeah. So start with my name. I'm Heather Strother. Live at 3 Alexander, is that right? And actually have a son who does ESY program, and I'm part of the CPAC. So, you know, I think the purpose just to express to be here tonight was just kind of really better understand, as a starting point, the purpose of the policy is one question. And I guess that's a question I came here to understand, and also just to put out there, it's not totally clear to me the need for a policy, as opposed to I think the handbook idea is excellent. Because it's much going to be much more clear how the program is implemented through a handbook and explain to a parent kind of all the steps. So I'm not totally clear on the purpose of a policy, so maybe that could become clearer down the road. But that's kind of not as important. I had a couple of one big thought, which is the handbook, and I think it would be really important to have it be a collaborative process where parents could help think about the content of the handbook. And because I think knowing parents' questions about how ESY works and the areas of confusion would be an excellent way to develop a handbook, because you would be able to fill out the gaps, you would be able to kind of think about it from the perspective of a parent coming into ESY. So I really would put a pitch in to think about how CPAC members and also members in the community who, you know, are interested to work together to develop that. So I don't know how that would happen, but just putting that out there as a recommendation, because what I was hearing is maybe developing the handbook over the summer and then kind of presenting it to the community in the fall, and that sounds like it's more of a done product. So I'm not exactly sure, and that doesn't seem as collaborative. So just a thought. I don't feel the need to get into content tonight personally, because I think that's being teed up to kind of have discussions about content and programmatic concerns, other things. So I'm going to kind of, I just think my comments are more about the process and trying to set up a good process to work together to address some of the concerns.
Great. Thank you.
Eileen Locke, 9 Cole Drive. I'm one of the co-chairs for the CPAC. Here to support Heather.
All right.
But I think the drive for the policy that Dr. McLeod referenced really came out of some other peripheral issues. And I think the root cause of it, when I looked at it, was really communication. And change is always difficult. But I think, as Laurie saw, it got hit by a lot of people without any level of communication. So I value the policy, but I think more importantly is the collaborative effort that needs to be developed around a program with parents. And I also think some of the staff that participates in ESY, because I think, you know, these are the teachers teaching ESY. They probably have a perspective that I don't even understand. Mm. So, and I think in that, and I think my daughter's a senior, so 12 years of ESY, I have some little bit of knowledge. ESY is regression, but I think the part that we kind of lost this year, and I think from hearing from a lot of parents, is the education is really important, but a lot of these kids have special needs, and social skills is a gap, and that was pulled from them this year. And I think, you know, everyone needs to look at that to understand a lot of these kids don't have those social opportunities. So when you pull out yoga or whatever, that's hard. Your idea of Parks and Recs is awesome. When I grew up, when I was younger, I had a sister with special needs, and every year the school got her every summer involved with the Park and Rec camps. I think that's awesome, and I think that is like a gold mine to look at in the future. But that, again, is collaboration and working together. So I think hopefully what ended up over the last few weeks can end up to be collaborative work going forward.
Great. Thank you both so much for coming out tonight. I know it was not the best of weather to get out here, not to mention all the things you had to listen to beforehand. So appreciate it, and certainly the perspective is much appreciated.
So. Yeah, really. You sure you don't want to wave at the camera and say hi to your son, right?
I've already checked on his homework. About enough. Thanks for your time. I appreciate you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay. All right. So we now are going to have Dr. McLeod's report, and which just surprised you. Isn't that what we talked about before?
Yeah. Okay. I didn't know if there's only one thing left on new business, Laurie. Did you want to just do
the warrant?
It's not really related to my report.
Oh, I thought that was.
No,
it's sorry.
Capital article request under old business.
Oh, okay, yeah, sorry.
Up to you.
I was seeing these as related to the FAQs, and if they're...
So this is the two articles that would have been related if we had made a change to the turf field. But right now there are two warrant articles that
Can I suggest, though, can we like really throw off the order of it? Because
sure.
I feel like the warrant, so we're going to have a discussion about our capital articles.
Yeah.
And specifically, we're going to have a discussion, I think, about our capital articles and if anything has changed with respect to our desire to have those capital articles continue forward. And so it feels like if we discuss the warrant before we discuss whether or not we want to keep those as capital articles. Does that?
Why don't I make this suggestion, and then you guys can all tell me whether or not I'm crazy, because we've already screwed up the order of everything at this point. But
our live audience is really having a problem with it.
So we have two pretty easy old business items that we could do, and then we could pull all the budget items in one. But I don't know if that makes sense or not, Dr. McLeod, based on your report on tech. So you tell me if we should do the travel and the tech.
No, it's not related.
Okay.
Yeah, go ahead.
So why don't we do old business A and B now, and then we will do the capital article request, the town meeting warrant, and Dr. McLeod's report all kind of together. Not literally, but you know what I mean. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Makes sense to me.
Does anyone else have an issue? Okay. All right, so let's do old business A, which is the high school varsity girls lacrosse final overnight travel approval.
So this is truly a final approval, and sometimes we have initials, and sometimes we have finals, and
Sometimes the person filling out the form gets it confused, but this one was approved. You did approve the initial, and this is the final for a upcoming trip. Jean, I did check into it, and they are leaving at 3.
Oh, okay.
So this does not include missing schools. So I would recommend approval of the final overnight travel request for the girls' varsity lacrosse, traveling to Martha's Vineyard on April 28th and returning on the 29th, 2017.
Did anyone have any questions, discussion? All right, then I would seek a motion to approve the final overnight travel request for the girls' varsity lacrosse team to travel to Martha's Vineyard on April 28th, returning on April 29th, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Kavanaugh.
Birchman.
Birchman, sorry. I was trying to figure out whose voice it
was. I should have just let you do it. That would have been consistent.
All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes, and it's unanimous and so carries. And our next item, Dr. McLeod?
This was an oversight. You know how you voted for me to be the participating board member for accept. Tech needs the same kind of vote, and this was an oversight that we didn't bring to you earlier. Megan and I have made note for the fall to make sure that we bring it in a more timely fashion, but it's really just a matter of procedure that they need to have your vote. So that's why it's on the agenda tonight.
Gotcha. Any questions? All right. At this time, I would seek a motion to approve Dr. McLeod as the voting member for Tech for the 2016-2017 school year.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, second by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
And it's unanimous and so carries. All right. So, Dr. McLeod, I would suggest at this point that we do your report.
Okay.
And then the capital article request, and then the town meeting warrant. That's the order I would suggest.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm going to start. I just have something I want to read to you, and then I'll do Tech budget overview because it's really quick. So I'm just going to do my best at pronouncing this. Makis Asimakopoulos wrote a letter to Mr. Kilduff and to me. Dear Tim, this is impressive news. This had to do with the naming of the school. Congrats to all of the people involved and who supported this initiative. The Marathon community around the world is very proud of this development in your town. Having the privilege to manage the annual Authentic Marathon here in Athens, Greece, I have to tell you that I'm really happy about this news. Congrats again, and all the best to all of you in Hopkinton and Boston. Yours, Makis Asimakopoulos. I'm really sorry if you ever see this.
I don't think he's watching.
PhD, General Manager, Athens Marathon, in Hellenic Athletics Federation, Greece.
That's very cool.
And it's so cool, right, that it's just so important to the community, to the Marathon community, and they take this very, very seriously. And this is, there were a number of communications from different people. I had to read this one because it came all the way from Greece.
That's
exciting stuff. As far as the Tech budget, part of the requirement for Tech, and Nancy, you were there with me, is that we review this or make it available to each of our school committees, although you are not required to vote. And so I did include the entire thing in your packet, but I did want to just provide the highlights, which Liz was so excited about, and it was one of those, well, this is a really difficult budget conversation because the budget includes a 25% reduction in the Tech member district assessment fee.
That's good.
It also includes no increase in Tech member tuition rates for the FY 2018 school year programs and a 4% increase for summer programs only. It highlights a continued investment in assistive technology and Tech's one-to-one Chromebook program, and it also highlights includes at least 50 free online courses per district, a value of $15,000 per district. I want to point out a couple things just really briefly, and then Jean has asked at a future meeting for me to provide a breakdown in terms of what the benefits are of belonging. We consistently have, because we have the virtual high school program,
We consistently do not fill all 50 of those seats, and we've tried in a number of ways of doing it. I'm constantly bringing the information to the administration at the high school that, hey, we've got these 50 free seats. But because we are so involved with virtual high school, there's just less interest in it. And the other thing that's become really clear when you look at the participation rates across Tech is that the neighboring communities like Walpole and Norwood particularly are really taking advantage of the wonderful programs that Tech has to offer. But distance is definitely a challenge for us. We only have 2 students currently participating. I'm thrilled with the offerings, with the staff, with the programs. But when parents have a choice and they go and look at different programs as they have the opportunity to do, it is a trek to get down there. And I think that's our biggest challenge as far as participating, more participation in Tech. But it's a pleasure to work with them, and it was really exciting, Nancy. I didn't get to say this out loud because I had to leave, but when I was listening to the teacher who was doing an overview of all of the strategic initiatives that had taken place, those were directly in line to the strategic planning that I had been part of the year before, and it was just so exciting to see what they've done in a year with that program and with data and with, you were there, Jean. You were in a different group.
At that point.
The strategic planning.
Yeah,
but, and Dr. Kavanaugh is going to attend the strategic planning session at Tech along with me this year. And she is very interested in representing the school committee as a board member so she can learn more about it.
Oh, great.
Next year, which is, I think, going to be exciting. Too. So that's it in a nutshell as far as Tech.
Can I say one thing on the virtual high school? Because I just went to 8th grade parent night where it was like an introduction to the high school and they mentioned it. Yeah. But when I went to the website, and I've done it a few times trying to find it, the only place it comes up is as part of the student handbook.
Oh.
It doesn't have like its own, I was like under parents, I was under students, I was under links, I was under everything. And it's only a couple mentions inside of a document.
Oh.
So maybe if it had a little more visibility, because I was looking for it because it really has cool, like in the handbook it talks about some courses that you can take, which seem kind of real worldy, but they're only mentioned in text.
Okay.
So some way to access it.
I think they're all included when the kids go online to register for classes.
Oh, okay.
They see all of the.
I couldn't find it myself, like under parents. Or
yeah.
Things, so.
No. Yeah. It's that's like another exactly perfect example. Like maybe you don't realize because the kids have the access to it when they're doing the registration. But again, parents might be looking for that before. Uh-huh. The other thing that I'm thinking is, you know, if our students who are here during the day are more. Are taking more advantage of virtual high school or some of the Tech online classes instead of the Tech classes. I wonder if that's an opportunity that we could offer to some of our homeschool students.
Yes, we've talked about that.
I think that would be great.
Exactly.
I mean, there are free seats, and that's
exactly.
A great way to, you know, my kids have taken the online courses, and you do, in many of them, you have to collaborate with students in other districts, like, you know, in real time on the across the computer and whatnot, so that might be a good opportunity.
I've made note of both those, VHS visibility and online courses through Tech and homeschool students. I know we've also talked about access for the students in the START program as well.
So. Exactly.
Cool. Questions, comments on Tech budget? Okay. So the FAQs that I know that you've all received, I think the most efficient way, or I would like to suggest that the most efficient way of us going through this is to consider the ones where there has been a recommendation or a suggestion that perhaps this article may in fact be removed. Because if it is, then we don't need to spend any more time editing the FAQ.
Before we jump to that, you had in your superintendent's report, town meeting report draft, and I was just trying to figure out what that was.
You had asked me to come prepared to give you a draft of what I might be presenting at town meeting. That's what that is.
Okay.
I do have it.
Oh, gotcha.
It's a PowerPoint.
It was just
All right. That's all right. When I looked in the packet, I was like,
I didn't skip it on purpose. I wanted to show you and then get your feedback.
Gotcha.
And you were going to give me feedback so that we could have lots of time to prepare. And I'm excited to share with you what I have thrown together. No, I didn't throw it together. Put together very carefully and thoughtfully.
Great.
Okay.
I don't disagree with your suggestion on the FAQs, unless anyone else has an objection. All right. Because this is going to lend itself to what the other...
It will. So if we could jump to...
Our old business item on capital article requests is going to lend itself to that discussion as well.
Okay. So the Elmwood receiving door, Ralph and I confirmed today that we do have funding. It will require coming back for a budget transfer. But there is remaining money in the Elmwood extraordinary maintenance line based on some painting or money left over from after the painting projects took place, and then Univent, is that the right thing? Univent replacement. The suggestion would be that we go ahead with the receiving door replacement because using money from the that account because it's a safety concern. And then talk about, particularly because we're also going to be talking about an SOI for the Elmwood School, really considering what repairs we should be doing at this time and what repairs can wait. The Elmwood School receiving door is not something that can wait, and we do have a funding source that, again, I'm repeating myself now. So Ralph and I believe that this is something that could be removed from the capital article request.
So can I ask a question about, like, I understand you found what the funding source is, but typically when we have end-of-year balances, we are trying to help our spend in the following year. So would this type of balance be impacting that?
Yes.
Well, it would be $25,000 less. But I think, and this is going to be our discussion when we get back to old business, we really are trying to be strategic in the kinds of things that the school committee might consider removing in response to the request from the Board of Selectmen and Appropriations. So this would be one.
But there wasn't a request from Appropriations.
Well, Appropriations, well, now we're kind of getting off track, but Appropriations listened to our presentation for the very reason that we haven't had this meeting yet. Because, and we said that, you said that really well to them at the very beginning of it, which is we can't really, until we have the next school committee meeting and we discuss what the school committee is willing to do or not do, we can't really...
Yeah, I mean,
this
is extraordinary maintenance, though. So I don't know why we would save. I mean, this should be what extraordinary maintenance covers.
Except that it was over the
amount,
$25,000. It becomes
dollar
can
amount.
Can we do that?
Can we do what?
We can pay it through extraordinary maintenance, even though it's capital.
It's been clarified with CIC. It's just like the technology leases that we do through the budget process that exceed $25,000. They're not terribly concerned about that.
Don't we have a maximum limit on prepay?
No.
You can do it at the end of the year?
Well, yes and no. You can prepay collaboratives to the full extent that you wish. You can prepay private tuitions for one quarter, three consecutive months.
Oh, so the collaborative, so basically the accept transportation gives us essentially a room ceiling over and above what we ever have.
That's
left.
Correct.
Okay.
So I'm not disagreeing with you, Kelly, on the extraordinary maintenance piece. What I was getting at with appropriations, since you all weren't there, and I might as well fill you in. There were definitely questions about our operating budget, but the overall response was very positive to everything that we had done, and especially I would applaud Mr. Manning for actually, he took like a very much a back seat in the meeting with appropriation and allowed all the members that were there to ask questions and then chimed in about what he had saw during the process. So that it was a very positive meeting. As far as the capital went, I did start off before they even dove into any of them by saying that the school committee had made a decision during this meeting to go over the capital piece, the capital article requests, I'm not saying that right, the capital requests from the schools to determine whether or not we had any changes based on the fact that just about 6 months has transpired since we actually made the requests and that things, circumstances may have changed in terms of our priorities, in that we hadn't made any final decisions yet. So with that lens, they did ask some questions about some of the articles. Some articles they didn't touch at all. But I didn't hear any strong opposition to any of them other than there was a concern over whether or not we could get one of them passed. But there wasn't a concern from the Appropriation Committee about putting it forward, just whether or not we were concerned about getting it passed. So that was the lens in which I was having that exchange. So I agree with you. Like they may have asked more questions if we had said that it was final.
Yeah.
But they also had the opportunity to still ask questions, and there weren't that many. So I guess my difficulty with this is, like, I don't have a difficulty with using extraordinary maintenance for something that is extraordinary maintenance, I guess, and especially because you're in the time of year now where I guess you're banking on the fact that we're not going to have any furnace blows up, you know, right. Kind
we
of.
We have a leak after tonight.
a big concern for us would obviously be, like, a boiler or something and not having heat in the next couple months versus, like, I guess I'm just trying to say, like, if we did this, what are we risking, like, for the rest of the year?
Nothing.
We're not risking anything. This is something that has to happen. So it either happens now or it happens in July.
Okay.
And the money's right there in the Elmwood funds. You know, when we met today with Al to be planning out our summer projects, etc. I said to Ralph, well, what about the other extraordinary maintenance accounts at the other buildings? And he's like, they're basically at zero. So just interestingly enough, that money is there. And it feels like the right thing to do.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, end of year balances are just that. And this is money that was appropriated for projects of this nature, and it's even in the same school. So I think, in addition, this is a security concern.
Yep.
So that means it's a security concern tomorrow, just as much as it is on September 1st or whatever day the students come back. So I would say it makes much more sense, given that we've identified that we have the ability to just take care of this now.
I would agree with that. I think, to Lori, to your concern, the one thing I would just say is it does reinforce the fact that we all know around this table, which is that one of the things that this budget does is it yet again runs us tighter on the spread room that we have with respect to unexpected special ed costs. And so, but acknowledging that we have $25,000 of extraordinary maintenance money in that account, I think it's the right thing to do.
I think just to pile on to what John just said, what I do think is going to be important is that if, you know, I think it's good tonight to go through and pare down some of our capital requests in support of the requests that's been made to us and the work that other town departments are doing. That said, once we do that work, if the message comes back to us that it's not enough, I'm not willing to dip in to next year's operating budget to cover this $25,000 that we could have taken as a savings and put forward in the next year's budget through end of year balances. So I guess I would just say I think it's important to, I think it's, you know, fair given the work that everybody else is doing and important given the safety concerns, but I want it to be noted going forward if there is a further request that we gave up something that we weren't necessarily, you know, that is impacting next year's operating budget.
Agreed.
Well, that lends itself to the other piece that I was remiss to mention in my report, but it lends itself to this, is that the Board of Selectmen had requested my presence at the meeting on Tuesday, the 11th, because they wanted somebody on hand from the committee for discussion about our capital article requests. So after we finish our discussion on capital article requests, we can talk about whether or not anyone else is available to attend the meeting. Dr. McLeod and Ralph have offered to attend the meeting. It's not that I have any lack of confidence in Dr. McLeod and Ralph attending the meeting without a school committee member, but based on the relationship strain that is there at this point in time, I think from that standpoint, I would prefer that a school committee member be present for the meeting, but only if the school committee member is comfortable in having those discussions with the Board of Selectmen on their own. And if they're not, then I have asked if there is another meeting that we could attend, because I'm unable to make that evening. So we can chew on that after we make the decision on the capital article, but I did just want to let you all know that that invitation was extended.
Okay.
All right, so we're not voting these quite yet, but nope, it sounds like we all as a group are in agreement of removing this one, so we don't need to go through the fast facts, I assume?
Correct.
And we'll reserve the vote for the end of all of the discussion. All right.
The next one that I'll bring to your attention is system-wide technology upgrades, because that's another one where, you know, when we looked at all of them, we took a look, we had a conversation with Ashok. You know, as we've discussed, what started off as a 3-year plan has now become a 5-year plan, just in terms of, you know, working through the budget and being able to do whatever we could in each budget. If the school committee were to vote to reduce this request from 100,000 to 50,000, it would mean that the upgrades, can you help me, Ralph? What would happen? The upgrades to the
sound system at the high school and access points at Elmwood.
Right. Is that in there?
That's what's
yeah.
in the fast fact.
Yeah. Okay.
It would be postponed.
There it is, yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. So he felt comfortable. I mean, it's clearly, it's always disappointing to have to delay something that you were hoping to be able to do. But within discussing this plan, the technology upgrade versus the system-wide security upgrade, there was no comfort to delaying any of that. And so it would mean the access point upgrades. So as Ashok explains to us, this is really, as we get more devices, we need more access points. But they've been able to have kids, for example, on MCAS testing. There have not been concerns with that. And I think when he looks carefully at his rollout plan for the Elmwood School, he feels that we could delay the additional access points there to be consistent with the rollout of the one-to-one Chromebook initiative, which has also been delayed, not because of any discussions here, but because of the bigger budget discussion that we had from where he started to where he ended up. So that would be aligned. And the sound system in the auditorium, I'm not going to say it's a nice to have, because I don't think we have anything in our budget that was a nice to have, but it is something that could be pushed forward yet another year. They're not thrilled with it, but they can make do.
So the 50,000, it would be then just for access points in the middle school?
Well, the 30,000, so the remaining 50,000,
yes.
Lori?
Yeah, I was going to say, we should probably just say what's included.
Mm-hmm.
Instead, we say what's excluded.
Well, if this goes through as an FAQ, it would. Right, but this would be worded completely differently. This was really more
providing the information for discussion purposes.
Oh, okay.
Right? So
okay.
This would be changed completely if it went, depending on what your decision is tonight.
Okay, so you're not looking for editing on these from us. You're
in fact, I'm going to suggest, given the hour, that the editing piece of this I can manage just through your feedback on, you know.
So I'm going to put it out there. The $30,000 for the sound system in the high school, I'm movable on. Mm-hmm. If that's, I don't have a lot of familiarity. I don't spend a lot of time in the high school auditorium. I don't know exactly what kind of shape that's in. I won't vote for an article that takes $20,000 out because, as you said at the beginning, this is the reality of the world. Every building, more devices are coming in. Whether or not we have the one-to-one Chromebook initiative, there are more devices that are going in and accessing that network at that school. By pushing it off a year, it feels like we push it off a year, but we're going to be sitting here next year and pushing off something else in exchange for that. This has been a result of careful strategic planning by Ashok and the administration and the whole administration. And I totally appreciate the fact that everybody is looking really hard. This just isn't one that I think when you start delaying technology by a year, that's when you fall behind. You see that in private industry. You see that in public budgets. I just think for $20,000 to keep up, to do that kind of equipment upgrade, I just can't support putting that off a year.
Was there an SOI lens to this reduction, though? I know we had talked about that, or is that not really part
of
this?
No.
It's all movable, right?
Oh, yeah. And
okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, but great question.
I don't disagree with John on it. I mean, the first thing I thought is the wireless access points on both schools should stay. And then when I read closer as to what was happening, I understand what Ashok was doing in terms of lining it up with the Chromebooks, I feel like when you talk about a wireless access point, doesn't that also include any like teachers and staff in the building are also accessing it? So like, I feel like there's just other considerations that are there as well.
Are there issues with the access for the devices that they're already using in, like, are the teachers having difficulties with their access?
The teachers are not. There have been ongoing improvements, but we do go back to the point that the more devices that are introduced, the more there's going to continue to be. And it's painful to make any of these recommendations to school committee. So I do want to clarify
totally
that this is not like we're all working together to try to figure this out. And it's intended to be a discussion and not a reaction to a recommendation that we're making. We've just looked as carefully as we can to any possibilities.
Mm-hmm.
Any of these possibilities are not made without concern about the very thing, John, that you mentioned, which is what else are we going to have to put off the following year? And Ashok does point out, you know, that this was supposed to be a 3-year plan, and it's already a 5-year plan because of decisions that we've made along the way. Whatever the school committee, wants to do is what we want to propose. So this is just meant to be a place for us to have a discussion.
Yeah. I would only be comfortable with the pushing off of the access points at Elmwood because it coincides with the Chromebook initiative.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they need to go hand in hand when the Chromebooks are rolled out. This has to be in place. But that's not next year. So I feel like this is kind of a symbiotic relationship between the two.
I guess the one thing I would point out here, too, though, is that on a number of levels, we don't always have full control over the number of devices that are getting added to that network. I mean, there's just sort of the ancillary day-to-day that pretty much everybody that goes into that building now knows what the wireless password is. So you're getting all kinds of devices that are running through. And then we even come into instances where we're fortunate enough to receive a grant, whether it's from HEF
or that, you know, something like that, that is going to put a bunch more devices into Elmwood. So I think that's while it ties to the while we can't do the Chromebook one-to-one without this, I don't think it necessarily fully mitigates the need for this that we are not doing the Chromebook one-to-one. And I just, again, I think it's one of those things where, I mean, building up wireless capacity is important. And I think it's great that the teachers haven't experienced any connectivity or bandwidth issues that they've reported. I mean, the utilization of this on a daily basis from all teachers at all levels. I mean, I get emails sometimes from my children's teachers at, you know, clearly when they're on a planning period at, you know, 10:30 in the morning. So they're clearly using and accessing the network frequently. So I just think it's a worthwhile investment. I've said enough.
I feel like it is a difficult choice, but I do feel like that is something I would be comfortable pairing off with the one-to-one as well.
Yeah, I mean, I think I said at the beginning of this, I'm particularly uncomfortable postponing things that are one phase of a multi-year plan. I still have a great deal of concern about, just because I was here when we were all doing it for very valid reasons, but just sort of kicking things down the road. So I would say, you know, I think for right now, I'd be most comfortable reducing this by 30. Maybe once we've talked about all of them and we get to the vote at the end, maybe I'll feel more comfortable about it. But I absolutely want to do our share, but I absolutely do not want to put us in a bad situation next year. And I just really feel like we don't have a really clear understanding of what FY19 is going to look like. So these big ones that are multi-year articles make me nervous.
All right. So we all agree that there's going to be a reduction in this one. We just don't agree on what the reduction is at this point. So when we get to the voting of the articles, which we're not there yet, then we can
make a motion
vote
then
on that. The only thing that I'm going to just say that hasn't changed in all these discussions is nothing. We have been given no new information as to why we're even being requested to make these reductions since February 28th. And so that's still out there.
Well, yeah. I mean, I think I know that we all are frustrated about how everything has gone this year, but at the same time, I do feel like, you know, all of the other departments that we work really hard to collaborate with are going through the same exercise we are. And I definitely think we need to make a good faith effort to make some reductions. But I think I think it's fair to be cautious about the impact that's going to have on us going forward. I think we've all been really clear that we're not willing to look at the operating budget. I think this is the area where we're willing to look, and I think you've made some really, or you are about to make some really good recommendations that we might be considering even in a different year where this request hadn't been made to us. So I think that that's responsible, but
I completely understand your point, and I don't want us to get too hung up on the grander philosophical when we're talking about the tactical, but I do feel obliged to say you're right that the other departments that we collaborate with are going through this, but, and this is my opinion as one member of this committee, they shouldn't be. This, again, I want to keep grounding us in the idea that the request is being made because the Board of Selectmen believe that the people of the town voted for projects that they essentially don't know what they cost. And they're asking us to cut services and improvements because they're not willing to go to town meeting with a tax increase that is reflective of three large projects that the town, in most cases, I think all cases, overwhelmingly approved. So I struggle. So it's responsible to keep looking at this. And every year we keep looking at this right up until the point when sort of the deadline closes. We should be. If the $25,000 of extraordinary maintenance, we should look at whether or not that should be spent here. But if the exercise is to work into a target based on a request from the Board of Selectmen, I'm still completely of the opinion that I have no motivation whatsoever to do that, because I believe everything we've asked for in our budget and our capital are real needs, and that the people of the town did not vote for those three large projects and put the caveat on the end that said, but when the tax is hit, make sure you cut down on the services in the budget so that we don't get hit by such an increase. I actually give the people of the town credit for knowing what it is that they're spending. And so while I have sympathy for the other departments that are forced to go through this, I think it's wrong, and I don't necessarily feel like we should be cutting just to participate in an exercise that I think is not actually what the town is looking for.
Well said.
Well, and I mean, in addition, I think the piece is that we did already go through this exercise in November and December, and we made cuts then. So I think that's also the frustration. But neither here nor there, we were not bringing this onto the budget, this discussion onto the because of at the behest of the Board of Selectmen. We were bringing it on because we wanted to look at what our priorities were, based on the fact that we've had 6 months has transpired and things have changed. The receiving door, we now have a better understanding that we have extraordinary maintenance that in November, none of us would have been comfortable utilizing at that time based on the fact we had a winter in front of us. So let's just look at it from that standpoint at this point, although I don't disagree with a word you said, John. I want to keep us on task at least. And so our next one, Dr. McLeod, that you wanted to look at?
You know, I think this one is an easy one based on your point that you just queued up perfectly, which is there's so many unknowns. We don't know where we would put this thing for our own reasons. And
are you talking about?
Just the next page, sorry, buildings and ground storage facility.
I think I had mine mixed up because.
Oh.
Yeah, I had mine mixed up.
Okay, sorry. The next page in my book is buildings and ground storage facility.
Okay.
And I think for all of the reasons that you just said, this one doesn't make the sense that it made when we took it up during our budget process, particularly as it relates to the Tedesco Irvine Land Use Committee. And I would suggest that we consider removing this one at this time for those reasons.
Yeah, I have
It's just the design phase.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I agree. So
look, I just saw nodding heads and it doesn't.
I agree.
Well, because we're going to vote at the end, right?
Yeah. Right, yeah.
What's your next one in your
next
book?
One is Hayden Row Campus Paving.
Mine are definitely all out of order.
Paving? All right, I'm on paving. We're caught up.
Sorry.
It's all right.
No, but I might have missed it.
No. Doesn't matter. Just tell us.
We're on paving. We're good. We're all there.
We got there. I just couldn't find it.
So this was the design phase. This is something that we've worked hard to do, which is to break our projects into two-year timelines so that we have design and we have a really accurate number. And we don't get stuck with the same problem we had for the air conditioning, depending on some old studies. So this was going to be the design phase for the Hayden Row campus paving. It would, to all of the points that you're making, put it out yet another year. It would mean that next year would only be design. And it would push it, you know. So for all of the points that you made, John, you know, I'm less excited about this one. You know, just even walking that road, and knowing what can happen with another year of weather and potholes and challenges, this I think it needs to be clear that this puts the actual paving part of a project out another 2 years. So it was there. You know, it goes back to our responsibility around maintenance and capital planning and
preventative maintenance that we've really worked hard and the school committee has really supported over the past several years, not making buildings and grounds the fall guy. Mm-hmm. It's always a place that cuts were happening, I've learned, through Al and Ralph in difficult budget years. It was cut, cut, cut to buildings and grounds, and I think you've worked really hard to get them back to a place where, you know, they have what they need to do their job. So, you know, I put this out there as, you know, something that could be considered when compared to some of the other requests that are absolutely impossible to even suggest that we reduce.
So the only other thing that I would raise in regards to this, and I don't disagree with anything you're saying, is that in light of the fact that we are wanting to put forth the turf fields, you are likely to be increasing your activity on those roads as well. So if you push out the paving timeline and it doesn't repair, get these repairs get done, your access road that you're utilizing for those turf fields and potentially for revenue-driven activities out of those turf fields may also be impacted. So it's something to consider in terms of if you push it out. So,
yeah, I have a thought about that. If you're going to do a turf, the turf work next summer, I don't know how the construction vehicles will get to those fields other than being on the loop road. And so I would think that you would want to do repairs to the loop road after that construction was done.
Mm. Okay.
That just popped into my head. I mean,
yeah.
And thought of it before.
So that means what you're suggesting is that we actually do postpone this for a year so that we
pushing
do.
Pushing it out a year might make
that
more sense.
In the, okay.
Yeah.
It makes logistical sense.
Yeah. Well, it also brings it back to the.
Only if the athletic fields pass on the schedule that we are currently hoping
we're
that they will.
Gonna pay
it brings it back to the lens of.
Yes. We hold that hostage.
What we now know and making decisions as a school committee based on what is now in front of us, so we have additional information now.
Well, the question is whether or not you want to do the feasibility, the engineering study now to know how much it costs to then factor that in at, for another capital request at the time you're requesting the fields, because the timing can be such. But
that's
so I don't have an opinion on that. I'm just saying, like, if we're looking to find out if it's not makes sense to get an estimate over a year in advance, then don't do it. But I don't know how good those estimates are for what period of time. So
yeah, I think the smaller the time between the study and the construction, lessen your risk of price appreciation.
The other lens I'd like to bring in this regard that just occurred to me is I know that the sidewalk project has been delayed. So it does feel, as a member of the town, as a committee and a department is what I'm trying to say, that if that project is being delayed, then not considering delaying the Hayden Row campus paving seems maybe a little bit short-sighted in terms of the needs of the town.
I mean, I think in the context of the, if you don't think it's valuable to do to have the design done so that the repairs can be, if we have the design done now and the athletic fields are not for whatever reason on the warrant next year, we could put the repair work on the warrant at that point.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to waste money if the athletic fields are on and then we decide to postpone the actual work on the road, if that's wasteful of the design money because too much time elapses, then that doesn't make sense. But I will say, you know, the one point that hasn't been raised is part of the reason that we have tried to be more proactive about the loop road is because of a number of years of very strong feedback at town meeting about the condition of that road. And, you know, the lengthy process we went through figuring out if you could use Chapter 90 monies and you couldn't and all of this stuff. And so only just to say that that has been an issue of great importance to the people of at town meeting, you know, for many years in a row. So, you know, not that we take any of them lightly, but this is one that there's a high level of public interest in usually.
I'm going to miss those conversations about the loop.
I was actually thinking when it came up, we got to put something in the fast facts about why this can't be admitted as a town road.
Yeah, that's very true.
Yeah.
Very true.
So, I mean, I know we're going to vote on this later. I have no idea on the pulse at this point in time. I mean, I'd be comfortable delaying it a year based on the fact that we are hoping for this other project to take place, and I hadn't thought of construction vehicles, but I fully agree with you that those will destroy a road, and so it would make more sense to make them more symbiotic.
There's a pro con to that point to doing it this year, which is that the pro is when people talk, one of the things that we've heard in some of these capital projects like the field would be is there's the cost and there's the all-in cost, right? So if we hook back and do the repair of Hayden Row following it, are people going to perceive it as added on cost of the turf field project? And we could have a better sense of that if we do it now. But I think also to your point, Ralph, the further apart you are between design and construction, the better chance you have of that number not being as accurate as possible. So it's in my mind, it's something that makes sense to push off. I just think from a turf field marketing perspective, we want to make sure that we're upfront with the fact that this is a plan and that this is going to be a cost associated with
it. Well, I mean, the good news is that you can demonstrate over past years' capital project requests that this has been on for a number of years, and that we've had to push it off for various reasons. And then when we got closer to a project that was potentially going to impact the usefulness of the repair, we made a forward-thinking decision not to do it. So I think you have you have reasonable backup on that. So, I mean, I get what you're saying, because I know what you mean by, like, the add-ons, and that is certainly always brought up as well, but I think you have a lot of historical data to demonstrate that's not actually the case. So,
mm-hmm.
All right. So, does anyone else have any discussion points? Kelly, looks like you're going to pull your hair out.
I'm going to fall asleep. I'm trying to keep myself.
All right. We're not voting on it, but it seems that we're leaning towards removing it. Mm-hmm. Got it. All right. Because I'm trying to group these for when we do get to that point. What are we on next?
I'm asking Ralph if you did not do an FAQ on the air conditioning.
Yeah, we did.
It's
here.
It's HVAC at middle school?
After middle school and
That's the HVAC.
Not the
middle school. I didn't see one for the middle school.
Yeah, HVAC at middle school auditorium.
HVAC at middle school.
Yeah, we have them both.
Hawkins HVAC.
So this is the FAQ, and
so which one are we doing?
Is HVAC at the middle school auditorium. So basically, the air conditioning. We've been back and forth with the Board of Selectmen, with the town manager, and with the finance director on the funding source. I think that's irrelevant. I think we've been, you know, I know that we're looking at any changing views that we may have, but from the beginning, way back in February, if asked what could wait, there's a big price tag on this one. And although I have heard back is, well, that's being funded here now and it won't have an impact, I don't think that's our concern. Our concern is to look at our budget and see whether or not there's anything that we could live with waiting. And to me, this has a very big price tag that, you know, we've lived with the middle school auditorium the way it has been forever. We could wait another year. And then the funding source is again, not at one point in the back and forth discussions, it was, you know, part of
what they were asking us to reduce. And John, I know your reaction, your strong reaction to reducing just because they've asked us to. I understand it, and I understand that the points that you're making. So this is something that even before that request, when the original request just came before it got to Board of Selectmen, that Ralph and I felt this is not going to hurt, and it's a big, big number that could reduce towards giving up something. So I just want to give that background when it comes to this particular item. I know it's somewhere different on the warrant, but I don't think that for our discussion that has to cloud our decisions. So
it's funny because I've gone flip-flopped on this one a lot because of the fact that, you know, we put it before a town meeting last year and it got approved at town meeting last year. Now, granted, it was approved at an amount that was incorrect. Mm-hmm. But the difference for me in what we're deciding on removing and what we're deciding on keeping is things that are going to cause more deterioration and cost more money at a later time. An HVAC system in the auditorium will only deteriorate the comfort level of parents sitting in assemblies and plays.
A couple times a year.
And
town meeting.
And town meeting, which certainly I'm not missing the importance of that, but
usually we have blankets at town meeting because it's so cold in the front.
Well, that's because they have the doors open to cool off the rest of the auditorium. But so, for me, if I'm looking strictly at this from a want versus need and what's going to actually cause more, like, the whole kicking of the can analogy doesn't, it works well for all of these, but for me, for this one, yeah, you're certainly kicking the can down the road, but you're kicking the can down the road on a comfort versus an absolute need for either education purposes of the students or, or improvement of a true educational program. So that part to me makes it difficult to want to push it through. The only part that makes it that it hangs me up on it is that there was a positive vote last year at town meeting. Now, granted, our budget outlook at town meeting last year was different than it is this year. So that's where I'm struggling, but that is where I understand where you're coming from on this. So that's just my take.
Your first argument is really where I am strongly in that. To me, absolutely. Like, if we were bringing this for the first time, this is something that I would say, I think we can live without this. I feel I've become, over time, I feel like a major town meeting advocate here, that town meeting did vote for this, and it was a different price tag. And my general feeling is, I think we should give town meeting the opportunity to decide whether or not they want to adjust that decision based on the revised price tag. Like, I'm not concerned if this one fails at town meeting. If town meeting makes a decision to say, you guys came last year and we were in favor of putting the air conditioning in the middle school under a different price tag, this is too expensive for us now, okay. But I think it feels like we should give town meeting the opportunity to make that decision, since the current sort of on record opinion of town meeting is that we should put air conditioning in the middle school. Again, there are articles that I look at and I say, we've got to make sure that this story is told effectively because we absolutely need this and we need town meeting to pass this. I find myself sort of largely indifferent to whether or not this one fails, but I do, from a town meeting process, I think that I feel like the responsible thing to do is to go back and say, this is what you voted on last year. This is what happened. This is the new number. What do you want to do?
I guess I've kind of, like Lori, been back and forth on this one, and I am very compelled by what you say, John, about town meeting. My concern is that if it fails, because people are looking at so many different things, are we going to have difficulty bringing it forward? My guess is there are a number of people on other boards who might get up and speak against this particular article. And if it fails because of some of that? Are we going to have difficulty bringing it back if it's in fact something that we would like the town to have another crack at?
Depends on how hot the weather is that week.
Well, yeah, I wish we had an almanac.
and are they then weighing this against things that we have identified as higher priority? I don't have a strong yes or no, though.
I think I definitely think, you know, in the scheme of life, this is something that isn't critical to education, and if it's necessary, it certainly could wait. That said, we already have invested money in the design, so I guess my question.
We invested money in determining what the cost would be.
Right. So we were
of the design.
So we were already wrong on that once, and now that we have a revised number, how long is that revised number going to be valid for, or are we going to have to redo that number next year or 2 years from now? Because next year, this is a high-priced item, and we are planning at this particular moment to have another very high-priced item on the warrant next year. So,
good point.
You know, I don't want, we can't get it wrong twice. I was actually, you know, really leaning towards postponing this one. And I'm still comfortable doing that, assuming that we have confidence that the number that we that this number will be the number for the foreseeable future.
Right now, the estimate is 232, and we're asking for 250, including the money that was left over from last year's article. So you have a little bit of a buffer there.
Does that expire? That appropriation?
Not yet.
No. No. It does not expire.
But I don't know how much those typically escalate. I don't remember how much we asked for and how much we were off by.
Well, we were off by a lot because the project is just much more complicated than anybody thought it would be.
Okay.
So the scope of the work we underestimated.
Correct.
But now we have... Now we know the scope of the work, and that isn't going to change. It's just how much that costs
That's
is going to change. Okay.
So we won't really lose the money we put into figuring this out. Is that?
Okay. I've added air conditioning twice, and the price went up significantly between the two times I did, so I don't have any thought that our cost that we think it is now, if we put it off a year, wouldn't go up by 10% or so.
I mean,
we'd
probably have to add something to that. No?
Right. So I
save.
So between that argument and let town meeting decide, I would want us to go ahead with this one. And that's my opinion.
Okay.
Do I get to nominate who argues in favor of these ones when we go to town meeting?
So, Lori.
That happened at our reorg meeting.
I would. Mm-hmm. Suggest to the school committee, given the hour and that we're not nearly finished, that my suggestion would be that we still need to vote, but as far as the other FAQs, if people could, Jean, I already have some from you, I could redline the FAQs and bring them back to your attention at next week's meeting, the 13th, with your input, and I think it would be much more efficient with our time that way. So I like, John, what you said about, you know, we want the FAQs to tell the story, and sometimes when you're telling the story, you leave out important details just because they're so in your head. So we very much appreciate your feedback on, you know, changes to this, and then we could include, I will work with Megan to include all of your feedback and then bring it for your... I feel like we have time to do that instead of wading through every single one of these tonight.
Mm-hmm.
So if that makes sense, then we could probably move to the vote.
Well, no, because we haven't. I have no indication on anyone else if any of the rest of these are up for removal or not.
Okay.
I mean, I don't mean that we need to go through. I think everyone should be able to give you the red lines. But, okay, so maybe I can put it this way. Of the remaining capital articles, are there any that we would like to take separately
to pull, as consider to consider pulling.
So is it, we're talking about Elmwood, we're talking about Hopkins HVAC.
Buildings and grounds.
Buildings and grounds, and equipment, and then
security.
I don't want to advocate for pulling any of those. I do just want to ask how, you know, can, the number for the buildings and grounds equipment. Do we not know, like, the exact price of the equipment? Or
we do.
Is $30,000 the exact price? Or
yeah, we could break down each of those, but that's why it's an equipment request. You know, we had this conversation with Al, and basically, I mean, the way we're all getting really tired now, and I'm having trouble even putting my thoughts together, so I apologize, but the way that I would like to express this is we have really raised the bar in terms of our expectations for how we want our grounds maintained, and in order, I believe strongly, whether it's buildings and grounds or classroom teacher, for them to do their best work, we have to provide them with the equipment that they need. I think if we started to break down, you know, which of these things are needed.
That's not what I'm suggesting. I just want to know, do we not know the actual price? Like, this is a really round number, and a lot of times, you know, they give, like, the actual dollars and cents. That's all.
In December, it was $29,100.
Okay. Yeah. So I don't know if, you know, if other departments are giving that level of specificity. That's all. I'm not at all suggesting that we don't go forward with this.
Some of those quotes actually went back to last summer. So
that could be more.
All right. So does anyone have a strong opinion on removing any of the remaining Hopkins HVAC, Elmwood School Solution, system-wide security upgrades, and the buildings and ground equipment as from our list of capital articles that we're putting forth at town meeting?
I do not think any of those should be removed.
All right. So all of you are nodding no, and Nancy, thank God, said she didn't because I couldn't see her head.
Sorry, it's my
So touch. What we're going to do then is we won't have to discuss these, Dr. McLeod. We shall all we will vote on these ones, but the three that we were discussing removing, we don't have to provide comments on. But if you have comments on the other ones that you'd like to provide to Dr. McLeod for revise with a revision, please do so. And I actually will include myself in that because I took notes on all of them, but I didn't send them to you, so I will send those to you.
Or you could just hand me your notes.
You're not gonna be able to read them.
So the three are building and ground storage facility, the paving.
We haven't voted yet.
The receiving door.
We don't
those
know
were the
yet.
Three that we were considering.
Considering. There's one that we don't have agreement on what the reduction is, and there's one that I think we're definitely going to have to vote to see where. I mean, we're going to have to vote on all of them, but all right. So, what we had left on our agenda was, well, we can't do the town meeting warrant until we do the decision on the capital articles. So, because of the fact that there's discrepancy on HVAC, so let's first do the capital article request under old business. And I would first suggest that I would seek a motion to remove the Hayden Row campus paving article, the buildings and ground storage facility article, and Elmwood receiving door article from the capital article request submitted by the school committee for 2017-2018.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Knight. All those in favor?
Yes.
And it's unanimous, and so carries. So those three are officially removed. And
we also already removed, we voted, right, on the athletic fields? I know, I'm getting tired too. Okay, so we took
we
that
We did
off
vote
too.
On the athletic okay. fields, so you're right. Now we have four that have been removed. I will also seek a motion. Do I have to seek a motion on the ones we're keeping? Because we already
voted
them?
No.
All right. So I don't need a motion on those. What we need is, I would
I don't know what the motion is.
Which one are you doing?
System-wide technology, is that what you're doing?
Well, no, I want to do the HVAC one first. So,
are there changes to it?
No, there's just a decision on whether or not to remove it. So I guess at this point I would seek a motion to remove. Because it's already on there, so I'm not seeking a motion to keep it. Right. So I would seek a motion to remove the HVAC at the middle school auditorium as a capital article submitted to the town for 2017-2018 budget.
So moved.
Second. All right. So there was a motion by Mrs. Kavanaugh?
Yes.
And a second by Mrs. Birchman. Is there any discussion on the motion? All right. So I would seek all those in favor?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. And all those opposed?
No.
And so it passes 3-2. And it is removed.
I'm always hot at Emma's clothing.
All right. Now the... Sorry, I'm just trying to keep notes here.
Are you going to do anything with technology?
So the technology upgrades, there was... There's a couple options. So there's some of us that... We all agreed to remove the sound system, I believe.
I'm actually back on not touching this one platform myself.
I don't know if you're the same reason. I was actually thinking the same thing because
we've just taken a ton off.
Yep. And so,
I don't want to touch this one.
All right. I don't know how the hell I'm going to do this one. Sorry.
You got the discussion before the motion.
You can just look. For a motion, right? You don't need to seek a specific. It's really
Is anyone inclined to make a motion on this?
I would like to make a motion to remove the portion of the article regarding the sound system.
So to decrease
the article by $30,000. Thank you.
Second.
Lori. Oh, second.
Are you seconding? Well, I didn't hear anyone else second it, so I
didn't know if you were asking or saying it. No, all
right,
saying
okay. I'm sorry.
You go right ahead. Oh, my gosh. We're too polite.
Yes, okay, I seconded it. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. And all those opposed?
No.
All right, and it passes 3-2.
By
reducing it by 30,000. But okay,
it still remains as an FAQ, unlike the others,
right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I will resend the FAQs that I need your feedback on. Does that help?
Yes, and if you could, if you want it to be an ease of...
When I looked at it, I saw
me too.
You might want to send them in Word version or Google Sheets so that we can redline them for you so that you can actually see the differences. Yep. That might help you.
Resend remaining FAQs as Word doc.
So the other, we have another item, but the other question I have just in regards to these changes that we've made to the capital article request is... How are we communicating these to the town?
I think that's what they wanted to have happen on the 11th.
Well, I think we had to notify them ahead of the 11th because of the fact that it was supposed to be up for questions.
Okay.
So I don't know if that's something that we just send a note to Chris and Norman tomorrow or what.
Yeah.
Norman will do it.
I mean, there's
Apple
a distinct
possibility. Well, not tomorrow, really. Tomorrow.
Yeah, I can do it for them.
Okay. So we've taken care of all of our old business at this point. We still had one more item under new business, which was the town meeting warrant. So there were, I don't know, Dr. McLeod, do we want to get into the history here? Apparently there were two articles that were not included in the warrant, and one of them now is
probably moot because of the fact that we removed it. But
okay, right.
So, is that what happened?
What we're doing. Go ahead, Rob.
Where the confusion came about is that we had a meeting with Norman and we had a conversation with him about where the confusion was, and you know we felt as though we submitted our requests, or the school committee submitted their requests, and we were not totally aware, or we weren't aware of what the funding sources were going to be. And so it really just never occurred to us that we needed to submit warrant language.
Right, that was a new...
Right. So Norman has agreed that going forward that they will reach out to us to do that, letting us know which ones need to be submitted by the sponsor, because they're not going to be included in pay-as-you-go. So, in any case, I put together this language after having a conversation with Diane Sullivan from MSBA. So, and it's been reviewed, I think, by legal counsel, Ray Mieres.
Okay. So, the language you have before you has two warrant articles, but we just voted to remove the middle school auditorium as a capital article.
Mm-hmm.
So what I would suggest is whether or not, I mean, the motion at this point would be whether or not we approve the warrant article as drafted for the Elmwood School Solution. Does anyone have any questions or concerns about the language for the Elmwood School Solution?
Well, just to know, I mean, this, speaking from experience with Marathon Elementary School, see, I did it that time.
That's nice.
With respect to this one, there's really not. I mean, the MSBA basically writes these.
Yeah.
So if you don't have the warrant article written this way, they're not going to accept it. So there's really nothing we can do with the language if we want to put it forward.
Okay, great. That makes it even shorter.
Yeah.
And it's short. Just to clarify, all of our other remaining capital articles are pay-as-you-go.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. All right. So I would seek a motion to approve the warrant article language for the Elmwood School Solution as stated in the agenda materials.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Kavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Any opposed? All right. It's unanimous and so carries. So, at this time, we still have no public for public comment that decided to show up for our late breaking time for public comment, and we can move on to items by consensus. Does anyone have any need to pull any of the items by consensus separately from the group?
Yes.
Yes.
The minute. Which one was it?
January 9th?
Yes, January 9th.
Yeah, we can.
After this.
Yep. I'm sorry, what was
the minutes of January 9th.
You want to pull the minutes of January 9th out of the items by consensus?
I just have one edit.
No, that's fine, but we can pull them out of it, and then we'll talk about those?
Yeah.
Okay.
And Megan made a correction, not that it matters probably to the vote, but there should be a C under, so there's two B's. Oh. It says ABB.
Oh, yeah.
For which minutes?
Which one?
Under
items by consensus.
Yeah.
Sorry.
I don't know that it matters, but okay.
Okay. So we are pulling the January 9, 2017 meetings out of the items by consensus. So let's vote on the other items.
Okay. Superintendent recommends the school committee move to approve the items by consensus as outlined below, except for the minutes of January 9, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. And it's unanimous and so carries. And so now, Jean, on the
ball. I just wanted to insert a sentence before the second motion that said there were no comments or questions from the public at the hearing, because it's the minutes of our public hearing.
Is that the one you asked us about?
Mm-hmm.
And it didn't happen?
I didn't word it properly. I put none at this meeting, but it should be hearing. Is that?
No, I didn't see that in the minutes at all.
Public comments here.
Oh, I see.
Public
comments up. No, up before, because then we closed the public hearing. So what I was suggesting is
So we have the warrants to see before we...
yeah, they're down there.
Okay. We close in between there. The above this motion,
yep.
I would just insert a sentence saying there were no public comments, because that's that's the part
the
where they
there were no comments from the public.
At the, just want to make it sure that clear that nobody came and said anything to us that we were ignoring.
Yep,
that's all.
There's still time.
Sure.
All right, so we have a suggestion for an amendment. Does anyone have any objection? All right. Did you catch what the amendment was?
I think Nancy did.
Okay.
Did you catch it?
I wrote it down, and I can go back and edit the minutes and send them if we approve them, too.
Okay. Are we comfortable voting them tonight?
All right.
So I would seek a motion to approve the minutes of the regular school committee meeting of January 9, 2017, as amended.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
And it's unanimous and so carries. One item before we adjourn is the item of the meeting from the Board of Selectmen on Tuesday, the 11th.
Okay.
Which will be a meeting to, I am told, this is what I'm told. The agenda item is to discuss the capital article warrants that we have put forth for town meeting. I don't have any idea of whether or not the meeting will be like the February 28th, where we were supposed to go talk about the capital article warrants and ended up talking about the operating budget. So if someone is inclined to attend the meeting, then I'm not going to prevent anyone from attending the meeting, although I just would make sure that whoever does is confident and comfortable and in speaking to all the warrant articles alongside Dr. McLeod and Ralph. If not, then I will ask if I can attend a later meeting this month, because they're trying to schedule it at the time of the regular Board of Selectmen meetings, and make it to that meeting. So I just need to understand from the committee on how they feel about this and if anyone has availability at all, because if you don't, then that's that it ends the discussion anyway.
I have a youth commission meeting, so I'm not.
I'm out of town.
I'm available.
She's like,
I mean, I have a conflict, but it's not more important than this. But,
Kelly,
I'd prefer not to be the one speaking to all the Capitol Warren articles, personally.
That's perfectly fine. Jean, how comfortable are you with it?
I'm perfectly, if you all want me to do it, I'm perfectly comfortable. I feel like this process has gotten drug out a lot, so if it helps move it forward, that's fine. I mean, all I can
speak to the
decisions that we made as a group, and that's all I would do. So.
And I know that you're also fully capable of saying to them, we were invited to speak to the Capitol Warren articles, and that's what we're here to speak to. Because that's my only concern as well, is that it turns into a further freefall on every and any other budget item. And not even necessarily related to us, as Keefe Tech was not related to us. So,
the only ones remaining will be the ones that you didn't remove as well.
So right.
They won't be asking us about the ones that you all.
I know, but that doesn't necessarily preclude other Board of Selectmen members from trying to ask questions on other items of the budget, of our budget, that I just don't think are appropriate for the discussion. So, and I know I'm fully aware that Jean's capable of talking to this, so I'm fine with it. I just wanted to make sure that you were comfortable with it, and because I also somewhat feel like I'm shirking my responsibility. But
oh no, you're not. I mean, I think if you're more comfortable, maybe you can just have a conversation with the chair of the Board of Selectmen and say, you know, I'm not coming. Jean will replace me. It's our understanding that this is what the conversation is going to be, and so that's what they're going to be prepared to speak to, and you know, so to just clarify upfront that you're all on the same page.
I've been in constant contact with the other chair, so I will make sure that that's clear. And I appreciate you filling in. And thank you, Dr. McLeod, for offering to be there as well, and Ralph, who's already taken off. So, all right, so that was the final item I needed to discuss out in the open, because obviously it wasn't just strictly a date issue. I really need to get more input than that. So at this time, I would seek a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Birchman. All those in favor?
Yes.
And it's unanimous and so carries. Our next meeting is next Thursday, April 13th at 7 p.m. here in the high school library. And following that, we will be at town meeting.
All right, good night, and thank you.